Well, good morning, everybody. Listening to the sweet sounds of Barry White. That was our old intro. Today's a Throwback Thursday here on Ben and Woods this morning. Good morning to everyone out there. We are here. We are live. And we're going to get it together today on a Thursday. Yes, a Thursday indeed. And I know that because it's our Throwback Thursday, old school intro here on the Ben and Woods program. I'm Woodsy. That's Paul Reindl, the executive producer. Good morning, Paulie.
It's a good thing we don't do Way Back Wednesday as well.
We'd be
that
screwed.
Would really confusing.
That'd be tough.
Throwback
you know.
Thursday, Way Back Wednesday, yep. Flashback Friday.
Flashback Friday.
No, we don't want that.
T word Tuesdays. We could do that. I don't think I can say that word. Turn off the mic. Can't say
I don't
think
you should say that.
Right?
Yeah, no.
That'd be fun. That'd be a fun Tuesday bit. I don't know that the wives would like it very much, but we could try it once.
I mean, every day is that day at my house.
That's true.
Brandon says tossback Tuesday.
Tossback. There we go. Just toss some shots back and whatnot. Benjamin Higgins, your friendly neighborhood sports anchor, is here. Good morning, Benjamin.
Feeling good. Everyone was very happy with Higgy yesterday, and while I know it wasn't me specifically, I felt like I got a little bleed off on that. Just good feelings all around for Higgies in San Diego.
A little extra juice. Many are saying that I transferred a lot of good luck to Higgy. He was my battery mate for the first pitch and had not had a hit yet. Catches one low and away slider to a righty from me and goes out and has a monster, well, at least a monster inning. One monster inning, but what an inning it was. I mean, just one of the best innings you'll ever put together as a catcher in the big leagues. Yeah. You really can't do much better.
He caught a good game the rest of the nine innings. But, yeah, the one inning that only a handful of guys in baseball history have ever accomplished what he did in the fourth inning yesterday.
What of course, we'll get into it. Was there a number on that?
I think it was like five other guys.
Last guy was Benji Molina or something like that, I think.
I heard Jesse saying, like, I need to look up or I need to get the information from ESPN Stats and Info, but I never actually heard
Two would-be base stealers thrown out and a home run hit in the same inning.
Well, so good day for the Higgies. Was your day as good as his?
My day was solid, if unspectacular.
Okay.
It was kind of a normal day, but nothing went wrong in terms. I got to stop by our Odyssey Beach cleanup yesterday on my way to work.
What a
I didn't
move.
See either
you
of you
scab.
Guys there.
What a move that was.
Adam was there. Michael was there.
Oh, good.
JR. You're very happy to see me there supporting the cause and
you
supporting the team.
Scab.
As we dreamed of a cleaner San Diego yesterday.
Well, in your case, you actually dreamed of it because you didn't pick up any trash.
I was there for moral support.
So you went and just dreamed on it.
I did.
They actually helped create.
I encouraged. I did some words of motivation for a few of the team members.
Unbelievable.
I walked around with JR for a few minutes
as he
picked up a couple of pieces of trash. It was at Fiesta Island, and remarkably, it was already fairly clean there. I mean, it seems like a few other groups had already kind of picked it over before we got there, unfortunately, and there wasn't a remarkable amount of trash to pick up while we were there. It was actually quite nice and beautiful, but, you know.
It's very Odyssey of us.
It's the effort that counts, right?
Very Odyssey. Let's go clean up a clean beach. How's that sound?
I was surprised. I was stunned. I was expecting, this place is going to be absolutely, you know, a nightmare when you go down there. No, it was actually rather lovely. It was breezy. It was a little cool yesterday. It's supposed to get, did you see the weather forecast?
I saw some winter storm moving in today.
Oh.
Yeah. Hold on, quickly. I think Jose has you pegged wrong in the chat. He says that's a scumbag move. It wasn't a he was in his work clothes.
I was on my way to Channel 10.
So
I was dressed up, not really for...
Yeah.
Trash pickup, you know, wandering around Fiesta Island. So I just came and, you know, said hello to everybody.
Which is nice. You stop by.
There was certainly the discussion, like, is it better to just not show up at all, like a couple of other people I know? Or is it better to at least come by for a few minutes since I had the opportunity while I was heading down to work at Channel 10 and show my support for the cause? And I thought that's probably a... It's probably a good thing to do, to at least be there if I can for a little while.
Well, you know, the thing I fall back on is I like to be there for my kids. And I had both kids yesterday. One's on spring break, the other one's not. So I picked up the young one and grabbed the older one and we went and had had a day together, as we have every day this week. I think being a good parent...
You make it sound like I ignored my children yesterday. I took them both for a sandwich. We had a nice lunch, sandwich before that, so I didn't neglect my children in order to be at the beach cleanup. It's not an either-or situation.
It starts at home. You know, being there for them is really the most important thing. And, I will be honest, everything else does fall second in priority. Now, could I have brought my two children to the beach cleanup? The answer is unequivocally no. It was right in the middle of their nap time, which is also my nap time. So there's just no way I could have made it. But I'm glad you did. Nice to have a representative
We
there.
Love a clean San Diego.
We love
here
a clean San Diego. We really, really do. We really, really do. But yeah, so you showed up and how was the mood?
Like, it was good. Everyone was happy to be there. Well, I mean, they gave, you know, everyone the afternoon off to go and pick up trash. I mean, I don't know if that's like off, that you're still doing something.
Yeah.
And you're not, you know, it's not free time, but everyone was out there in good spirits. And yeah, weather was nice. I mean, it was beautiful. Last few days, like dreamlike San Diego weather the last few days.
Postcard.
Perfect. It's supposed to be, according to Megan Perry last night, about 10 to 15 degrees cooler today, and then another 10 to 15 degrees cooler tomorrow when the storm comes in.
Oh, boy.
And the snow levels, she said, are coming down to about 3,000 feet, which is, we're talking kind of Alpine, Pine Valley, Julian. They're all getting at least a couple of inches of snow everywhere in our very low foothills and mountains.
April 4th. It's April 4th.
It is not like, oh, way at the top of Palomar or Mount Laguna. No, this is actually in areas where we have freeways and stuff. There's going to be snow tomorrow in San Diego.
How's that bode for this weekend?
I want a refund.
On
pay a lot of money to live in San Diego.
Property taxes.
Because
Those are due soon. Yeah, it feels like you should get a discount if it's going to snow in April.
That's tough. Is it supposed to be another weekend of rain? Like, will the Tier 1 baseball team
just
ever
Friday,
play?
Just tomorrow. Okay. And she said on the coast, probably quarter of an inch to an inch tops. Not a huge, like, drenching storm like we've had the last couple of weekends. But it'll rain tomorrow. And it's supposed to clear up this weekend, but still be kind of chilly on Saturday and Sunday.
Cool.
All right. Well, listen, there's your weather update from Ben Higgins and Megan Perry, of course, from Channel 10, the great Megan Perry, married to Greg, who works here as well. So a lot of connections
who
there.
Who had his kids here yesterday. No,
that was
Jeremy.
Yeah.
Had his kids here yesterday.
Spring break.
Woods God, he has to get his kids early. Everybody's off, bringing their kids to work, plugging them into iPads. What else are you going to do?
Well, I'm taking mine today to, I asked, because we're nearing the end of spring break. And my six-year-old's been, he's been beyond outstanding. Like, he's been so good this entire time. He hasn't complained. He hasn't bitched about, you know, Mom, I have friends that are skiing. Nothing. And none of those days will come. But so I said, what do you want to do tomorrow? Because I got to get my stitches out of my back today. I've got 8 stitches in my back that have been there for 2 weeks. Those are coming out today. I will miss the round table today, so sorry. You'll miss my brilliant insight on the Padres. That said, after that, I've got a dentist appointment that I have to lug him with me because Hannah has work. So I got to take him to my dentist appointment. They're going to look at the work that they did so I can put the crown on. And he's so laying in bed last night. He goes like this. He goes, swear to God, quote, oh, man, I'm going to be wrecked tomorrow. I go, what? I go, what did you say? He goes, oh, I'm going to be wrecked. I go, why are you going to be wrecked?
Boss is all over me.
Yep, Mom, right? And he goes, I got Mom's appointment, and then I got your appointment. And I go, what's Mom's appointment? He goes, she's getting her nails done with Gaga. And I go, oh, you have to go to that too? He goes, yeah, and then I got to go to yours. I go, what do you want to do? What would make you happy? He goes, Dave and Buster's. I go, consider it done. So we will be going to Dave and Buster's again.
After he has to sit through the nail salon.
And the dentist.
And the dentist.
Which is, listen, let's be honest. It's a lot for a 48-year-old. It's a real lot for a 68.
That time passes
six-year-old.
Slowly. I remember that.
Remember
that time
dragged,
passes really slowly.
And he's been with his mom at her office, and I've been picking him up at her office every day. So he goes and like helps her work and stuff. He's been great. So
now, back in our
him.
Day, we didn't have anything to plug into.
Nothing.
They rarely even had televisions in the waiting rooms of those places. There were like magazines.
I've vividly
Highlights magazine was about all we had as children.
Well, I vividly remember like having to go to work with my mom and stuff, and she's like, "Just color." I'm like, "Color for 8 hours? I'm going to sit here and color."
Awful.
So I would read and no. But that was it, and run up and down the stairs.
You know me. I did word searches. You know.
All day, like working for
circle
fence. There it is.
Circle. There
all
it goes.
Right, let's go. Saturday. Okay, found it.
Ooh, this one's diagonal upwards. That's a tough one. I got that one.
It is true. It's absolutely true. I would play hangman like with myself. You know what I mean?
What's the difference between these two pictures? Find the five things that are different between these two pictures.
Now Bo's like, I'm gonna watch Tombstone in high def with my noise canceling headphones. Like you don't get to complain about anything. And he did it. It was really sweet. Like. And so I said, bro, you've been so good. He's been out of school for 2 weeks. And I said, you've been so good. We'll go to Dave and Buster's. We'll get some mini corn dogs. We'll do it like we do. Play some Jurassic Park, which is his favorite game. And he was like, okay, no problem. So he's been great.
Connect the dots.
Connect the dots. Here, look at this. Oh, it's a house. Oh, yeah. Awful. Awful. Yeah, honestly, my mom was like an administrative assistant in Dallas. And, you know, single mom for a time. And there were those times where she's like, I have no coverage. So you have to come with me. Sit there. Don't say a word. You're 8 years old. Sit at this mini desk and color and read for 8 hours. And you're like, and she's like, if you shut up, I will take you to Wendy's at lunch. You'll get frosty. So I would just wear it. You would just, I have so much respect for all the single parents out there. It's hard when there's two of you, right? It's really, really hard to get coverage and be able to live a life and do some things you want to do. I have the utmost respect for the single parents out there because it's tough, man. It's tough. And if your kid's a pain in the ass, and luckily, mine's really not at the end of the day, and he's just going to go wear these appointments with me. And, you know, he gets the payoff of
I love getting to, like, age 10, probably at the earliest, 10 to, like, 14, anywhere in that range, where if I did have to go to work
tag
with
along.
My mom,
yeah.
I was getting paid. Like, she would put me in the back and, like, all right, put all those files away.
Dude.
You know, absolute crap, busy work. But then I'd get, like, $50. You're like, this is amazing.
My mom also, when we lived in Connecticut, she worked for a real estate company. William Ravis was the name of it. And the reason I remembered is because I must have stuffed 75,000 pieces of mail for William Ravis. So I would sit at a desk and fold stuff, and then the old, you know, smooth it out, put the address labels on, all that.
So many envelopes.
I think she gave me
I had a glue stick.
I think it was like 20.
George Costanza's
fiance. It was like 20 bucks per 100 envelopes stuffed or something. So you just sit in there and wear it. And you know what? When I look back on those memories, they're fond. It's a fond.
My mom worked for an optometrist, mm-hmm. so I would stuff hundreds and hundreds of envelopes trying to get prospective clients into the office. And anybody that did come in and become a patient, I'd get like $100.
You get a little kickback.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
I don't know that I ever got $100 from the kickback.
Yeah, but that's good. The prospect of knowing it's there, that's the thing, is like a bonus is a really good thing for people if they think they can get it. You tend to work
like we'll
a
give
little
you 20
harder.
Bucks for the day. You'll stuff 1,000 envelopes.
Right.
And then if one of those hits,
you'll make $100.
Yeah.
100%. So it makes you want to do good job. But so spring break's coming to a close, mercifully. And then everything gets back to its regular scheduled program next week. So yesterday was one of the uglier wins, but wins are wins. We don't complain about wins on this radio program. We don't complain about wins. We just don't. Betty will set the menu for us next. It's a Throwback Thursday. We've got two of my favorites that we've had, and I had forgotten about really both of them. So I'm excited to play those for you today at some point. And boy, we got a new bit cooking.
We got to
figure out.
I had some homework to do yesterday.
Paulie had some homework. We got to figure out how we're going to weave this in today, but it's spectacular.
Out of pain comes growth.
Exactly, we're going to need to ask for some help, I think, too.
Yeah.
I'll explain why.
We will.
That's all coming up. Let's check traffic with Kelly Danick, and we are off and running on a Thursday morning. Glad to have everybody with us. San Diego, enjoy it before it starts snowing on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. It is menu setting time here on Ben and Woods. Good morning. It is Thursday, Throwback Thursday. That'll come up later in the program. As Woods mentioned, we get a couple of really fun throwbacks, one involving Joe Musgrove. That was a great moment on the show right around his no-hitter.
It's so good.
Which the anniversary, when's the anniversary? It's 3 years ago, right? 2021. What's the actual date of the no-hitter? Okay, we get a whole newspaper article, so just subtract one day from whatever the newspaper says, and we will know what date Joe's no-hitter actually took place on in Texas against the Rangers. So the headline there, say it so, Joe.
The headline on the paper says Sunday the 11th, but that doesn't sound right because didn't we come in and do a, I think it was Friday night. It would have been Friday the 9th.
And we came in Saturday and did a show.
Yeah, we did. We're good like that. We do things like that. Saturday shows and whatnot.
Every once in a while.
Yeah.
April 9th, 2021.
Yeah.
Okay. So it was 3 years ago coming up this.
Next week.
A little early next week, yeah.
I was just noticing on the stream, if you can watch us on YouTube, by the way, I was turned to the side like this, and it's really a good, you get a good look at my dewlap when I go to the side like this. Not, I just need to remind myself to never do that again whilst I'm in here. Don't dewlap this today.
Look out. That
was our incorporator word this week for Jesse, if you missed it. The little flap of skin, often under animals, but also radio hosts,
yeah,
that just kind of hangs down.
Yeah.
Just called a dewlap.
And blows in the wind.
Worked it into his Tuesday TV broadcast. Jesse had an amazing game yesterday. We'll get into some of that audio as well. Our Padres wrap-up is coming up here at the bottom of the hour, as Woods mentioned. Wasn't a particularly good performance by the Padres. Joe Musgrove was good, but it was the kind of game yesterday that the Padres never won last year.
Mm-mm.
And baseball teams do sometimes win games like this, and it was kind of stunning that last year the Padres never seemed to come out on top of one of those weird games. All of the weird games last year they lost, but yesterday was a weird game that they won. So to me it was a sign that maybe at least a little more normality is going to be setting in this year, which we could use a little normality for your San Diego Padres. So
normalcy.
Normalcy is also a good word. So we'll get into the Padres wrap-up in our next segment.
I will say this. I don't want that to be the norm. Games like yesterday, be the norm.
I can't do that.
That yesterday's game was an anomaly.
But they're unavoidable.
They are absolutely unavoidable.
If every baseball game was like that, I wouldn't watch baseball.
Dude, it's a good point. If you knew, hey, man, every game is going to be like this season. Nope, 162 of them. You're going to win some. You're going to lose some. Holy smokes! I need some laughers in there. I do. I need some. I need some 9-1. You know, five runs in the first. Kick back a little bit. Yesterday was a grind to get through. A grind, and they did it. They did it.
Had some interesting info coming out in The Athletic yesterday at 7 o'clock. Want to talk about the Ken Rosenthal, Dennis Lynn piece?
Yeah.
Involving the Padres and the Miami Marlins and trade talks that at least were going on as late as spring training and could be continuing today, with the Padres showing interest and making an offer for Luis Arraez, the two-time batting champion, and showing a ton of interest in Jesus Luzardo, the pitcher. Now, they ended up getting Dylan Cease, so don't know if that's, you know, still on the table or not, but could the Padres still be pursuing perhaps a bat like Luis Arraez? Is that why they haven't signed Tommy Pham or Brandon Belt, because they want to save that money under the luxury tax level in case they make a trade to bring in a guy like Arraez, who's making $10 million this year? We can discuss that and the possibilities coming up at 7 o'clock. We'll play a little Real or Fake on a Throwback Thursday. Chance to qualify for the trip for Las Vegas and the tickets to see Cool and the Gang. Don't do this in its normal spot at 7:35. Another piece in The Athletic that dropped early yesterday. We didn't talk about it, but Annie and Elston got into it. Britt Giroli writing about some of the inner machinations of Juan Soto, Scott Boras, his time here in San Diego, going all the way back to his time in Washington, and now his first few weeks and months with the New York Yankees, getting off to a very hot start with that team and getting set to almost certainly hit free agency this offseason, where they're going to go for another record market-setting type of deal for Juan Soto, whether he's going to get it or not. and you know what kind of didn't go well while he was here with the San Diego Padres.
I was pretty fascinated by that article yesterday, and listen, this is we do this here. They do it in other markets too, not just here, but people were looking for the gotcha. You know, and they thought that they had found a few of those gotchas in there with Juan Soto. I really took the other side of it and am happy to present that side later in the show. Interested to see what your take is, Benny, on it. It was a really well done piece. It really was. And I learned a lot from it.
I also did learn a lot from it. There were a couple of things that did bother me about Juan Soto. Not necessarily like personally. I don't think he's a bad guy. But there were some things that didn't jive well with being on a baseball team that's trying to win a championship and counting on that guy. And we can talk about that.
I can't wait for this.
I can't
in
wait
our
for
7
it
o'clock hour.
I feel like I already know what you're going to say, and I already know.
I know how to rebut.
How to just punch you right in the mouth.
Second half of the show, you had, it's more athletic because we got Eno Sarris. It's Thursday, which means it's a smart baseball Thursday. And Eno Sarris.
Who else can we get on
from the Athletic's going to be with us. So thank you to the Athletic for the treasure trove of Ben and Woods content for the show today. Paulie will have a Reindl Report in our 9 o'clock hour. And then don't forget, we're also going to give away more Eric Clapton tickets. But don't forget, it's a Roundtable Thursday as well, and I'll be sticking around at least for another hour from 10 to 11, joined by Annie and Elston and Gwen and Chris as we discuss the first basically full week of the San Diego Padres season presented by Roundtable Pizza. Now, you have to get your stitches out.
Big
I have no
kiss
problem
ass,
with
big
that.
Big kiss-ass week for you.
I have no
it?
Problem
Beach
with
cleanup
that.
Appearance and roundtables.
Do you think you should be able to have some of the Roundtable Pizza they bring in,
no.
or are you not eligible?
I'm
for
not
it?
Eligible.
You don't deserve it.
No, I'll wear that.
Paulie, I have no problem with you eating Roundtable pizza, even though you don't stick around for the Roundtable
right.
either.
Yeah, no, I avoided it
ahead.
Last time. I'm going to stay
you?
Away this time. I don't need pizza right now.
Yeah, the stream will play on the Roundtable, Tom. It will be available online, and then I think it will be replayed later in the day as well.
I think you have to switch. If you're on the Ben and Woods channel, you have to switch to the 97.3 The Fan
channel.
Standalone
for the stream, but we will be streaming it as well.
And then I think Gwen and Chris replayed at 5. So if you miss it, you can listen then. As
or
well.
If you want to hear it twice.
Yeah,
you
if
can
it's that
do that
good.
As well. If it's really, if I do a really good job moderating, you
I need
say,
you to do such a good job that we'll replay it again
tomorrow at
6
a.m.
tomorrow.
I would never. I could never give up our 6 o'clock hour.
But I am a really good moderator.
You're
you
really
say,
good.
So
you are. I'll
it
give
might
you that.
Be worth it for a three times play.
Imagine listening to the 97.3 The Fan Roundtable 3 times. Like, yeah. This was unbelievable.
That is commercial free.
It
is nice.
That is
the greatest thing I've ever heard.
Thanks to Roundtable. So that's a busy morning. We got 4.5. Well, I've got 4.5 more hours. Here before we're all done. So let's get into it with our Padres wrap-up. We've got a winning game yesterday, so we'll hear the highlights from Bob and Tony on the radio, and then we will get into it when we come back with San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. So I believe we do have confirmation on the date of Joe Musgrove's no-hitter.
I don't know. Can you trust this source?
Well, we were talking about it. We were trying to figure it out, and I got a DM on Instagram from the lovely, lovely Diane Musgrove. Now, she...
Any relation?
She is the woman that birthed our beloved Joe Musgrove, and she just writes me on DM. 4/9/21 I wrote, are you sure? Just kidding. So, yeah, a mom is not going to forget that.
No.
Ever. Ever.
And Danny tweeted, said that show that we did the Saturday, April 10th, after the no-no, was the first Ben and Woods show I ever listened to. Been listening every day since.
Love that.
See?
Love that.
So glad we came in and created a new tier one member by doing that show the day after Joe Musgrove's no-hitter.
Joe's Musgrove. It was one of the best Musgroves I've ever seen.
I prefer Joe's Musgrove.
I've seen some other Musgroves, Musgrove. But Joe's Musgrove was the best.
Ben's Musgrove, not that good.
Not that great. Mine was okay.
We're all growing our Musgroves.
Our Musgroves
out
are out now.
Honor of Peter Seidler.
My Musgrove.
All right, let's check traffic, and then we'll get into last night's or yesterday's game, the win over the Cardinals, our Padres wrap-up just ahead here with Ben and Woods on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danick.
Big problem along westbound King Freeway before Federal, a fatal accident involving a motorcyclist. This got the two left lanes blocked. You might want to consider taking westbound 8 out of the East County. That's looking pretty good right now. But again, westbound King Freeway before Federal, two left lanes blocked for at least another couple hours, guys. So plan accordingly. Also stalled vehicle partially in the fast lane on northbound 805 before Balboa. I'm Kelly Danick with Ben and Woods, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
I love winning, man. I love winning. You hear what I'm saying? It's like better than losing.
Oh my God, I'm so stiff.
Miss any of the Padres win yesterday? Ben and Woods didn't.
What up, crew?
We've got you covered with all of the highlights.
I like it when the Padres win.
Yeah! Yeah!
It's the Padres Wrap-Up, presented by Hamul Casino. With thrilling slots and tables and all the best rewards, Hamul Casino has all the fun you're looking for. Hamul Casino, fun above all else.
Yeah!
Give me a do damage.
Do damage!
The 3-0 pitch. Misses inside, ball four. He's walked in a run. The Padres have a 1-0 lead here in the bottom of the first.
Fortunately for Zach Thompson, when you're inconsistent with the zone, you don't get those close calls. That pitch looked like it could have been right on the corner, but because he has been spraying balls really all over the place, he doesn't get the call there.
Thompson's 2-0 pitch to Fernando. Ground ball to the left side. The runner's going to score over to second base for one. Back over to first. It's not going to be in time. RBI for Fernando. And the Padres have a 2-0 lead. Runner goes. Pitch is taken for a strike. Throw down to second base is a one hopper. Xander takes it. Puts down the tag and gets him. Oh, what a nice play by Xander Bogaerts to pick that ball out of the dirt and get the tag down. Brendan Donovan is cut down. The old strike him out, throw him out, two down. 2-1 Arenado. Fly ball in the center field, not well hit, may fall in for a base hit, and it will. A little blooper that's going to allow Contreras to score from second base, and all of a sudden it's a 2-1 Padre lead here in the fourth. 3-2 pitch, swung on, driven down the left field line and deep. Going back is Donovan. He looks up. It's gone. First hit of the season for Kyle Higashioka, his first hit as a Padre, and it's a home run. Padres have a 3-1 lead here in the fourth. 1-0 offering, ground ball left side, could be two. Ha-Seon Kim has it over to Xander for one. Back over to first, stretched by Jake Cronenworth. Does he stay in the bag? Yes, he does. 6-4-3 double play with a great stretch by Jake Cronenworth to finish it. And Joe Musgrove works out of the jam. Runners go, the 3-2 pitch, swing and a miss, strike three. Got him to chase the fastball upstairs. Joe Musgrove works out of the jam in the sixth inning with a strikeout of Nolan Arenado. He strands two. One pitch to Nolan Arenado. Ground ball to short, this could be two. Underhanded to Xander for one. Over to first, in time, double play. Robert Suarez rolls the 6-4-3 twin killing, and he puts an end to the Cardinals' eighth inning. Robert Suarez trying to get the final out against Victor Scott the second. The 2-2 pitch. Swing and a miss, strike three. He got him. Went with the fastball at 99 miles an hour upstairs, and Robert Suarez locks down the 3-2 Padres victory with his third save of the season. He gets a big hug from Kyle Higashioka. The Padres will head out. They will celebrate on the field as the Padres were able to salvage the final game of this three-game set and take down the Cardinals by a score of 3-2.
I thought Joe was Joe. That was, you know, I think pretty vintage Joe Musgrove. Very good early, very sharp, good tempo. Everything was crisp, you know, landing his curveball. He had the sinker going, was able to throw to both sides of the plate and open up, you know, the plate for him. He was open up the plate, and he was also under the zone, and he used every, you know, he pitched. That's what Joe does. He got a good idea how to pitch, and did a nice job getting through the six.
He was fantastic. His Musgrove was working yesterday.
It was.
Joe's Musgrove.
It was sharper than it had been the first two games, and you could see that he kind of got locked in that second start after the rough first inning. Kind of something clicked in, and he was able to carry that over. Six innings yesterday, five hits, just the one earned run on the blooper by Nolan Arenado that wasn't hit particularly well. Just one walk, seven strikeouts, just a very solid performance. The Padres needed that. They had not had a single game in their first eight in which they had allowed less than four runs to their opponent. You're not going to win a ton of games if you're always giving up more than four runs. You'll win some, but you've got to have... And we talked about this yesterday. You have to have some 2-1, 3-2 wins. If you're going to have a good season, these are the kind of games you occasionally have to win. And they're the kind of games the Padres never won last year. A one-run game. They're 1-0 in one-run games this year. They were, 9-22 last year in one-run games. They need to have a better record in those. They've got one under their belt now after their first opportunity.
Is that also the first win collected by a starting pitcher
this year? It was the first dub pitcher win. You know, I mean, Yu Darvish certainly pitched well enough to get one the night before, which that's a good trend, and that's a nice trend for those two guys, certainly. You know, last year, Benny, we thought, hey, you know what? If somebody doesn't have their stuff, it's fine. We'll be able to outslug teams. And sometimes we did, but it wasn't really an outslug. It was more of a decimate that team 12-2 that day. Come out really cold yesterday. That first inning was a roller coaster ride. When Joe grazes the first batter and he gets on and you're like, oh my God, here we go again. Then the Padres come up and off of Thompson. You know, they're working good ABs, they're getting on, and it's bases loaded, and you're like, all right, let's cook. You know, now we eat. We put this game out of reach. No. I mean, Profar, great AB, gets the easy stake there with a walk, and, you know, you take a nice little lead. Then you score one on a double play, and you're like, guys, off of this guy right now, we should have 4-5 runs. Like, unquestionably. So you did start to get that panic that we're all so used to watching this team over the last couple of years. Man, I almost tweeted yesterday after the really weird double play we didn't turn with a poor throw from Xander, but a very pickable ball from Jake, a nice long hop.
This was in the eighth when Wandy Peralta was in and could not find the strike zone. It seemed like a miracle that he had rolled the double play like, oh, he's going to get out of this thing.
Yeah.
And then they couldn't turn it at first. Jake couldn't get the hop on the throw by Xander, which was low. But
it was down.
You know, it was a pickable ball. Massively. Just miscalculated the hop on that ball. It happens sometimes.
Yeah.
But you felt like, oh, this is the thread that's going to unravel this game for the San Diego Padres.
The tweet that I was going to send was something to the effect of, oh, no, we're allergic to success again. You know, I think we said that last year a little bit. It feels like they're allergic to winning. Like, you go win this ball game. You can do it. We know you can do it. You have the talent to go out and win a game like this. And things just started to crumble. And the way that they ended up winning it with Robert Suarez, that was unbelievable yesterday, what he did. And, hey, he didn't make it easy, certainly. He didn't make it easy on himself, his teammates, the city, the fans. It was a tough one. But he got it done at the end of the day. Went out and threw, I think, 33 pitches, five outs they called on him for. I can't say enough good things about Robert Suarez. He needs a nickname. I thought of one, but it's dirty, so I probably can't say it. But, I mean, that was an outstanding performance by him.
33 pitches.
33 pitches yesterday.
Now, he
hadn't
pitched in 6 days. They got an off day off tomorrow,
sure.
So you might Schilt strategically knowing that he can stretch out his closer, who is willing to do that. And Joe did say after the game, and you can take this for what you'd like, but he said having a closer you can go out there and rely on for more than just three outs is huge. Subtext in there, probably a little bit from last year when Josh Hader was a three-outs-only closer for the San Diego Padres. Yep. But a big, big save for Robert Suarez, stranding two runners in the ninth after getting the double play to get out of the inning in the eighth. After that, again, so here's what I saw in this game yesterday. This was the most 2023-like game so far this season for the Padres.
Oh, yeah.
0-for-11 with runners in scoring position.
Brutal.
Taking a lead but failing to capitalize on opportunities and add on when you should against a pitcher that you had on the ropes. You had your pitchers look good, but they walked four, they hit four, they gave opportunities to the other team to come back and beat them. It was just like last year, except the Padres actually won the game,
yeah,
and they always lost this game last year. That was really the only difference. This was a very 2023-like game for your San Diego Padres, and they somehow figured out a way to win. And Kyle Higashioka was obviously a huge part of it. As we mentioned earlier, first Padres catcher in history to throw out two would-be base stealers and hit a home run in the same inning. Happened in the fourth. Very busy inning. It was strike him out, throw him out, double play, double bloop single for a run, and then throwing out Nolan Arenado to end the inning at second. That was replayed. It was very close.
Very close.
Just was not able to overturn. It looked like he might have been safe, but maybe he came off the base a little bit and the tag was still on. They upheld the call.
Not enough to overturn.
Not enough to overturn. And then in the bottom of the inning, Higashioka gets his first hit with the Padres. It's a home run. Guy who has hit 10, I think, each of the last three seasons. So you can kind of hope, you know, in a backup role, you're going to get that from Kyle Higashioka. I didn't realize, though, and I saw his quotes after the game, how hard he took his first. This was just his second start, because Luis Camposano has started every other game. And he went 0-for-4 with four strikeouts in his first start. And he goes, that was one of my least favorite days ever. You know, first start with a new team, you go 0-for-4 with four Ks. So the fact that he could bounce back and have such an impact on his second game, you know, I think that locks him now in and feels good about his start here with the San Diego Padres. So that was really big for Kyle Higashioka, who we enjoy talking to and meeting at spring training. And hopefully he'll be that, you know, that backup catcher role. He knows his role, came in and did exactly what the Padres needed him to do in that game yesterday.
No question, man. And, you know, again, when you look at the box score and you see that your 2, 3, and 4 all took offers on the day. Now, Fernando did, you know, drive in a run, fielder's choice, I think. Wasn't a double play, was it?
He beat out the turn.
Yeah.
He was always going to beat it out,
yeah,
but he got the runner home from third, which,
yep,
you have to do. You know, that's part of the execution of the game.
Yeah, he had an RBI. He did walk twice as well, so he was on base. But 0-for-2 for him, 0-for-4 for Crony, 0-for-4 for Manny, who's now sitting on back-to-back 0-for-4s. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, some guy yesterday tweeted at the show and said, you guys need to call Manny Machado out. And I said, I will definitely mention the 0-for-8. You know, you can't have that from him. He's too good. And especially based on the guys that were on the bump. I mean, that's two guys Manny can handle, Ben, with ease, right? Like, not even an issue. This isn't, you know, this isn't glass now. This isn't peak prime Verlander. There you go. Hey, crap, man. Even the best guys taking 0-for-4. Those are two guys Manny is probably kicking himself going, how did I not get at least 3 to 5 knocks off of those pitchers that I saw against the Cardinals? So something maybe a little off with Manny. You worry about his health. But, you know, I wrote the guy back and I said, I'm happy to call out the 0-for-8. And Manny would tell you right now, I got to get hits off those guys. I have to. I'm Manny Machado. Like, I should own that Zach Thompson. And whatever, man. Hitting's hard. He's whatever. But you do worry. Is he healthy? Et cetera. And he said, well, you know, it seems like whatever. Manny's maybe injured and that's hurting the team. And I said, well, I'd rather have Manny up there as DH and you know, not. He has the potential to get 4 knocks in a game. You know what I'm
saying?
He'll
get hot one day.
He's going to get hot.
And then he'll be locked in for however long, and he'll carry the team.
I'm not too worried
about
it. You
won't know unless you keep playing him.
That's exactly right.
We've seen this with Manny.
You're not going to bench him.
He's had slumps every single season that he's been with the Padres, even as close to MVP year.
They all do.
He goes through down month. That was injury-related as well, but just doesn't seem like sitting is ever really an option. Now, I do want to point out, once again, had the whole which reliever is going to come through and which one isn't. Tom Cosgrove struck out the side, and then Wandy Peralta comes in, and he had been really good And all of a sudden, he cannot throw a strike. And you're just hoping he can get through his three batters so they can take him out of the game, essentially. And we talked about the missed double play, and that's when Mike Schilt went and pulled Wandy Peralta for Robert Suarez with one out, the tying and go-ahead runs on base in the eighth. And I was watching Jesse on television at that point at my office. Same. And I loved this moment yesterday so much. So the scenario is set up by Mudd, you know, trying to get out of the inning, and Jesse just played this to perfection.
Just looking for a little 6-4-3. 6-4-3.
Wizard. Like he knew it was coming. And that there is an experience that you get as a broadcaster when you kind of get a feeling with the batter, right-handed batter, tough pitcher coming in, you know, exactly knows what he wants, that this is kind of where it could happen. And it just worked out so perfectly, a subtly brilliant call by Jesse Agler that I had to immediately like cut and post on social media, and everyone was sharing that yesterday. It's a thousand
looking
times.
For a little 6-4-3. 6-4-3.
I just looked it up. It was 1.3 seconds between him saying three and the crack of the bat where it's going right to the short. You know exactly what just happened.
Well, he explains where he got it in his newsletter that just came out. And you get a shout-out in there, Benny.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it.
It says, P.S., credit to my buddy Ben Higgins of 97.3 The Fan and Channel 10 for appreciating and sharing the moment. And if anyone actually has a list of favorite double play calls, it's definitely Ben. He, Mudd, had told him the story of Skip Carey closing out a game. And he did the same thing. 6-4-3. He said, I love that story. I loved it, but I wasn't sure I believed it. And it sounded like one of those tales that gets told around baseball. It happened to him yesterday with Skip's son, Chip Carey, two booths down.
I know.
So cool.
We've got that Skip Carey call. We should play it for everybody.
Yeah, it's great.
When we come back, we'll also play a little game of Real or Fake on a Throwback Thursday. And I want to get into those Padres Marlins rumors that were popping up with the story in The Athletic. All coming up, hour number two of Ben and Woods next year on 97.3 The Fan. So we were just talking about Jesse's great double play call to end the eighth inning yesterday. Just subtly brilliant.
Yes.
And you said he sent out his newsletter, and it included the inspiration for that call, which was, and I don't have the date of it, but it seems like it was probably back in the 80s. Remember when the only games you could watch nationally were on TBS?
That's
like
it,
Atlanta
man.
Braves games, occasionally a WGN Chicago Cubs game, but you could see the late Skip Carey, Harry Carey's son, calling a bunch of games for the Atlanta Braves. And this was one of them. Of course, they always had the old movies that would come on before and afterwards, and they were getting ready to toss it to whatever the next movie was going to be. The Magnificent Seven was coming up as soon as the Braves game was over, but there was still one out in the ninth inning. And Jesse wrote that Mudd kind of shared this call with him.
He also says, he and I have regularly talked about trying to pull it off, and we've definitely tried a couple of times. The beauty of the trick, of course, is that you say something like that and it doesn't happen. It's a total throwaway line that no one notices. But when you get it right, well, it's a lot of fun. And yesterday we had a lot of fun.
So here is the original from Skip Carey and the TBS broadcast of the Atlanta Braves many decades ago.
A ball and a strike, runner at first, one up. The Magnificent Seven are warming up in the bullpen and will be with you as soon as Leonard hits into a 6-4-3. Six, four, three.
Just like that.
Just looking for a little 6-4-3. Six, four, three.
Incredible.
Beautiful.
Incredible.
It was
moment.
Even an homage.
Yeah.
It was not just a great call, but it was also an homage to a phenomenal double play call at the end of the game.
The Magnificent Seven warming up in the bullpen.
Robert Suarez from the stretch, see?
33rd pitch of the night. Oh, look at that. 6-4-3.
Manny Machado hit the bejeebus out of that one.
So good. Yeah, we've asked before, but like you see old movies, people really talk to them.
Brockmire.
Yeah, well, Brockmire's like, that's his bit. But like, people,
like Jesse's fantastic. Would he cut
he speaks
it
like a
in
normal
1948?
No, he could. They would be like, we can't.
You
have
talk
you.
Weird.
You talk really strange.
Man, no, see, you talk weird.
You talk really weird. See,
yeah. Why did they do that? And what changed? And when?
Darling, pour me a scotch.
Was everyone just kind of lapsing into a little Vin Scully?
When
back
did it
then?
Change?
I don't know.
And was it only baseball broadcast or broadcasters, I should say? Was it only broadcasters
no.
that talked like
you've
that?
Seen movies from the, you know, they show clips in the 20s. How dare you look at me like that? How dare you? And me? I would never look at you like that. And it's like, what is everyone's problem? Why do you speak that way? When they got, when they're like, cut.
Talk like what?
When they cut. All right, guys, grab some lunch. Oh, man, that was a really good take. You crushed that. That was cool. All right, cue it up again. Here we go. I can't believe you two go around my back with a two-bit hooker like that. Like, it's just the weirdest thing ever. It blows my mind.
Oh, man.
Somebody asked, do you really talk like that?
When I'm not on the air, I lapse into my old-timey Ben.
I asked this about Ben when I first met him. I asked this about Ben when I first met him, because he does have the deep, rich, broadcastery voice. And I said, do you talk? That's just the way you talk. But you've been trained over so long to talk like that.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
But
like when you're at home talking to your kids, you guys better get your homework done.
That's my favorite.
Right?
Pretty much. Yeah. It's. You know, like anything, you
doggone
just
got it. Don't make me come up the stairs.
The best way to make sure that you're consistent is just do it always.
That's fair, I guess.
If you boys don't vacuum the house by the time I get home,
somebody's ass is going to be in a sling when I get home.
Like
from
my kids
the news,
never vacuum the house,
Kimberly. Back to you.
Somebody needs to take out this GD garbage right now. I love that. Find myself slipping into show speak sometimes at home, too.
And I do believe that Don Orsillo will be back on television in San Francisco.
Speaking
and Jesse
of
will
deep
be back
rich.
On our radio broadcast
I love
this
it.
Weekend.
I love it.
All right, we need a contestant for Real or Fake. Chance to qualify for a trip to Las Vegas coming up here in just about 5 minutes. 833-288-0973 if you want to get on hold. Paulie will pull you sticky on the wait, and you can just listen to the show over your phone. But I want to mention this on the wait. Sticky on the wait.
Sticky on the wait.
Sticky on the wait.
I thought you said Paulie will put you sticky on the wait.
Sticky.
Is that like an Australian
sticky
saying?
Sticky on the wait.
Is that a saying?
Old Paulie over here is going to put
as
you sticky on the wait.
Paulie, line him up in the
queue.
As far
as you know.
Line him up in the queue. See?
Just didn't want to say put you on hold twice in a row, so I was trying to come up with another
that's
way.
That's a new
to,
thing. Okay.
So sticky on the wait.
Sticky on the wait. I like
and
that.
You can listen on the phone. So, yeah, Dennis Lynn and Ken Rosenthal dropped this piece yesterday after the Marlins fell to 0-7 on the year. Terrible start for the Miami Marlins coming off their playoff season last year. And there's already talk that the Marlins may not wait until the trade deadline to start selling off pieces. And one team that has definitely shown interest in Miami Marlins players, the San Diego Padres. A.J. Preller has been very actively discussing, so much so that during spring training, made like real offers, according to The Athletic, for players, including batting champion Luis Arraez, the 24-year-old or 27-year-old who's got 2 years of control remaining. He's getting a little over $10 million in arbitration this year. Now, of course, he's a second baseman. The Padres have plenty of middle infielders already on their roster. But
I believe he's also played some first. And I believe that he here would just be your designated
hitter. Well, yeah,
hitter.
And you absolutely need another bat. You need a designated hitter. And he's been one of the best on-base and singles guys, essentially, in baseball. Really, we've seen the last 20 years or so. I mean, no one bat to ball. You're not going to get a ton of slug. You know, a few doubles, about 8 to 10 homers. But the singles, they are there. Hit 354 last year. Hit, I think, 318 the year before and won the American League batting title with the Twins. Is this something that you want to see the Padres continue to pursue? And is this why they haven't gone out and made another move for a free agent? Because they don't want to lock up the rest of their space under the luxury tax level if there's still a possibility that they might be able to pick up Luis Arraez here.
I don't know. I don't know. Do you have to send someone back to help alleviate some cost? And would the Marlins
you wouldn't.
Do
the Padres
that?
Have enough room.
Do they?
Right now. The Padres, according to The Athletic that I saw, like 13 to 14 million.
Okay.
And he makes 10, and you're not paying all of that at this point because the season's already started.
Yeah, a little bit prorated.
So a little bit prorated. So you definitely have the room. You wouldn't have a ton of flexibility left, especially if you didn't unload or offload a salary back to the Marlins. They're be looking for prospects. They're going to be asking for
good ones.
You know, really good ones. I'm sure they'd start
Snelling.
With, you know, they probably start with Salas.
Get told no.
And then they're going to move on to, you know, some of these top pitchers, you know, guys that are in the top five on the Padres prospect list. Is it worth it for 2 years of control for a two-time defending batting champion, who, by the way, is off to a slow start this year. He's hitting like 206 so far for the Marlins, but could be that answer you needed. You know, that last bat and that designated hitter you've been looking for, not going to get much better, certainly not on the trade market right now. Not a lot of guys are available this early in the season, but he might be.
You know how I feel.
I don't know. I don't know.
You don't know?
Unequivocally, yes.
I don't know.
2 years, you said, right? This
year
and
next year? 2 years of
control.
Yeah, this year and then one more arb year next year before he's an unrestricted free agent.
Somebody said, I thought the article was insinuating they had enough room before they dealt for Dylan Cease. Is that the case?
I thought that was in regards to Lizardo.
Maybe that was for Lizardo.
Like they weren't sure if they were going to get Cease, so they were talking on Lizardo.
Yeah, if they had gotten Lizardo, they would not have gone after Cease. But once they got Cease, Luzardo doesn't make as much sense. Now,
Luzardo's cheap.
If you can get both
take
of those,
him too.
You get both of those guys and, you know, add Luzardo to your starting rotation. There's certainly no team that would turn down Jesus Luzardo, but that obviously increases the price even more.
It's interesting too. I mean, he's an interesting player in that you do need a designated hitter, you do need a bat. I think the thing that I who am I? What happened to me? I'm a trade your prospects kind of guy, really. Does he help this team? Yeah. Do I fear that he'll not hit here? Yes. Also, yes.
Adam Frazier style.
Yeah. I do feel that's – feels like it's always a possibility. Is it in your guys –
And that's a Padres thing.
Sure.
It's not a Luis Arraez thing.
Is it in your guys' opinion any sort – do you feel like, oh, so we are going – he. I mean, A.J. Preller knows, like, it's S or get off the pot. Does he help you make the playoffs? Yeah, maybe. Maybe.
Does this team look like they're close enough that a Luis Arraez is going to be the difference maker?
That's the,
maybe. I'm not sure.
I really don't know either, man. But if it costs you like a Lesko and a Snelling or something, that's tough. I mean,
look,
but
those guys could be great in 2029, 2027.
No, they're closer than that.
No.
I know. But the contracts that you've already committed to, the long-term contracts,
you
cannot
go for
wait
it.
Until yeah. those guys are in their age 37 season before, okay, now it's our window.
Yeah.
No, the window's now.
For most people, the prospect cost is the biggest stumbling block, but Michael in the chat says unequivocally no. We shouldn't be using our DH for a guy that will give us like five home runs.
Yeah.
That's certainly a concern since they're already using their first baseman on a guy who's not – necessarily a huge home run hitter, but I mean, a good bat's a good bat.
Plus, what happens to Ha-Seong Kim next year? Is he here next year?
Right,
could be your second baseman next year if Ha-Seong Kim doesn't sign
an
extension.
Not good defensively, really.
Not particularly.
Maybe him at first, Crony back to second. I have no idea.
That could make some sense as well.
I really don't know.
Well, it's certainly something to talk about, discuss, think about here.
Roberto says Cronenworth and top prospects for Lizardo and Arraez. I don't know that they want to eat any money whatsoever.
Doesn't seem like the Marlins way.
Right. No. I just don't think that that's what they're going to do. They're
I mean, if they are so enamored with the prospects and that's the only way they can get them, maybe you can get them to think about it. But I don't anticipate that as something that the Marlins would be doing. And, I mean, if you're trying to win, right now I think Jake is helping you win.
Yeah, I think so too.
So if the idea of getting Arraez is to get to the playoffs and hopefully make a World Series run, you're better off keeping Jake right now, who is being, you know, contributing on a daily basis. He's been playing really,
yeah,
really well.
Crony, he only makes $1 million more than that for the next few years. So, you know, but again, I don't know. I don't know what type of deals they could swing. I feel terrible for Skip. I mean, you're 8 days into the season, and they're like, oh, we're going to trade. He lost...
They didn't sign anyone in the offseason.
They signed
Tim Anderson. That's it.
And they've lost the first four guys in their rotation. Like, what? It's going to be hard to win baseball games like that, man. It really is. And so I feel for him. I know he's probably dying inside right now. And then they're like, hey, we're shopping your number one in Lizardo, and we're shopping Luis Arraez. So that's tough, dude. That's really, really tough.
All right. We got some callers on the line. Let's get to today's game of real or fake.
Some are here for the compelling sports talk with Ben and Woods.
You can go plow through another donut.
It's time for Real or Fake on 97.3 The Fan. Tell the people what they'll win today.
Paulie just looked at the...
Somebody in the chat asked if he plays left field, Arraez.
He has.
He's played 48 games.
Interesting. All right, we've got Jose on the line as our contestant. Good morning, Jose. How are you?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm doing good. How are you guys?
I'm good. I think Woods might help you on this one. If you can get at least 4 out of 7 right, you will qualify for our grand prize April drawing of a 2-night stay at the Westgate Las Vegas Resort and Casino. 2 tickets to Cool and the Gang. Get your tickets now at Ticketmaster.com. They are performing at the Westgate Residency through 2024. All right, so today on Real or Fake, in honor of Jay Moore's scheduled appearance in studio tomorrow here on Ben and Woods, today's Real or Fake category is Jay Moore movies.
Oh, yeah, I got you.
I will give you a movie title. You tell me if it's a real film Jay Moore appeared in, or a fake, in this case, a movie that Jay Moore was not a part of. Jose, you know anything about Jay Moore movies?
I know a little bit, hoping with a little help.
Let's see
great.
How you do.
I got you, dude.
Round number one, real or fake Jay Moore movie. Home Alone 4.
Oh, God.
Real or fake? Home Alone 4. You thought I was going to make it easy for you.
I did.
Jerry Maguire.
It's not going to be Jerry Maguire on this list.
Real or fake?
I didn't know there was a Home Alone 4.
Home Alone 4.
Oh, God.
Let's just guess, buddy.
I only watched the first one.
Yeah. I watched the first two.
Oh, man, sounds like a trick, but I'm going to go with a yes.
It's going with real.
Real.
Woods nodding as well, Paulie?
No. No, he was not in Home Alone 4.
Good right, for him. Right. I'm gonna applaud him tomorrow right, for turning that
round number
down.
Two. Here we go. The Adventures okay. of Pluto Nash. Real or fake Jay Moore movie?
Ooh. I'm going to stick with real.
All right.
Real?
Like yeah, real.
Woods likes it. Paulie does too. That's real. All right, that's 1 point for Jose. We're on our way. Round number three. Garfield the movie. Real or fake? Garfield the movie.
I'm going to say fake.
You're going to say fake?
I would say real.
Ooh.
That's just me.
All right, ooh. Jose, you locked in with fake. You're good?
All right, Woods. I'll go with Woods.
All right.
Oh. Fake.
He said fake.
You said fake.
Yeah, stay with
you know
him.
What?
Stay there.
Yeah, you know,
there.
You may have, tried to go with Woods. Woods wanted to say real, but you said fake, and you are right,
you're
Jose.
Right.
Congratulations. That is fake.
Oh, felt like I heard his voice in there.
All right, you are now, you got two. You're halfway there. All right,
you've
round
watched
four.
Garfield the
come
movie?
On, come on.
Kids.
The Love Guru. Real or fake?
It's a Mike Myers movie.
The Love
I'm gonna say
Guru.
Fake.
I'm going to say real.
Oh, God.
Jose, you got to give me your final
we need the
answer,
final
though.
Call, Jose.
Oh, I'm sorry. Real.
All right.
Okay. He says real.
Oh, no.
That's fake.
Ah! I killed him.
Sorry. All right. All right. Here we go. Round number five. Pay it forward. Real or fake? Pay it forward.
Fake.
Fake.
Never heard of it.
You've never seen that. That's the most famous movie I've got on this list.
Oh, really?
Joel Osment, Kellen Hunt, Kevin Spacey.
Oh, yeah.
Las Vegas, the teacher who was burned.
That was a great movie.
And then Haley Joel Osment gets killed at the end. It is, though, unfortunately, real. He plays the reporter who tracks down the story of the pay it forward kid, Haley Joel Osment. All right, now we got to get the last two right. Here we go. Round number six. Ice Cube's Are We There Yet? Ice Cube's Are We There Yet? Real or fake?
Ooh, Woods, a little help?
It's real.
He says real. Sounds confident. Don't know if he is.
I'll go with Woods. Real.
All right, he's going with Woods.
Yes!
Bring it.
That is correct. Which brings us to round number seven. For all the marbles.
How does this happen every single week?
Every time.
Real or fake Jay Moore movie. The Incredible Burt Wonderstone. Real or fake Jay Moore movie?
You making up movies now?
Oh, my God. What? Can I get a little bit more help?
I got you, dog. It's real.
Ho, ho, ho.
I'll stick with Woods. Real.
You sure?
Yeah. Woods seems very confident, and he is correct.
That's right.
Film follows Burt Wonderstone. Las Vegas, it's like a Las Vegas magician. Burt Wonderstone, played by Steve Carell. Jim Carrey is also in the movie, but it does co-star one Jay Moore.
Yep. I was waiting for some Suicide Kings, one of the best movies he was ever in. I want to talk to him about that tomorrow.
All right, congratulations. Jose, stay on the line. Paulie will get your information as we take a break, get you into Don't Do This coming up next. I've got an update on the Don't Do This team of the year, the Oakland A's, for you and their potential future. Starting as soon as next year.
And I've got an amazing, positive, cool story for Do This about a pitcher stuck in traffic.
That is coming up next after traffic, coincidentally, on Ben and Woods, 97.3 The Fan. And Don't Do This is brought to you by the Kraft Taco in Sereno Valley. Kraft Taco has some of the best quality tacos in all of San Diego. Go to thecrafttaco.com. Take a look at their happy hour specials today. Thecrafttaco.com. Woody?
Just got a quick update here in the Rashee Rice story that we've been telling you about this week. A little street racing left some people injured in Dallas, and he disappeared. Everyone ran from their cars, and, well, turns out now he is apologizing for his role in the massive crash on Saturday that left a lot of people injured. Put out a statement on Wednesday where he said, "Ben, I take full responsibility for my part in this matter." Never actually said if he was behind the wheel or not, but his statement did, he did post a statement today. "I met with Dallas PD investigators regarding Saturday's accident. I take full responsibility for my part in this matter. Will continue to cooperate with the necessary authorities. I sincerely apologize to everyone impacted in Saturday's accident."
Sounds like there was some lawyering involved.
Very much
so. How can we look contrite without admitting
guilt
necessarily to wrongdoing or guilt?
Correct.
But ultimately, what looked like the story when the car registered to Rashee Rice was involved in an accident and then he disappeared and couldn't be found, it was what we all thought it was. He was street racing.
Yes.
And was part of, at least he was in the car, one of his cars, and he was part of it.
Yep.
So that story has kind of fallen the path that we expected it to. All right. I will give you an update on the Don't Do This team of the year, the 2024 Oakland Athletics, who could be announcing, according to a report in Sacramento, as soon as today or tomorrow, that the team will be moving to a minor league ballpark, home of the San Francisco Giants AAA team, the River Cats, for up to three seasons beginning next year. That was a report from a radio personality in Sacramento. The A's did meet with Sacramento officials this week, and they're under a bit of a time crunch to make a decision because Major League Baseball's schedule is currently being formulated and will be handed out to teams soon for next year so they can start, you know, making travel plans and stuff. And while Oakland and Sacramento are not that far away, you know, different hotels, things that you need to start arranging, knowing where the A's are going to be playing. So Major League Baseball wants them to lock this down as soon as possible. Now, did the city of Oakland overplay their hand? They were demanding a $97 million rent payment for three-year extension for the A's to stay. And maybe the A's just decided that's probably too much. We'll go, and they can play on the cheap in Sacramento, where the
Sacramento,
where John Fisher, the A's owner, is also friends with the River Cats owner, who also is the Kings owner, Vivek Ranadive. So I'm sure he's going to get a good deal. Now, he will have to renegotiate his television deal.
Yes.
And won't be getting the $67 million a year, reportedly, that they got in Oakland. However, the Kings are on the same channel, so there could be like room for like, well, we'll still pay you some, but my guess is it's not going to be anywhere near the $67 million they were getting before. So there are some trade-offs here, but we could be finding out that the Sacramento A's will be playing in the AL West for the next three seasons or more until their Las Vegas ballpark is finally ready.
My man is just putting gum over holes in the dam.
Right.
You know, and a new one will spring, guaranteed, in the next couple of weeks. We know that.
Well, and the players' union has to approve this as well, because if the minor league ballpark isn't up to the standards that they are accustomed to in the big leagues.
Yeah, they're accustomed to Oakland. Well, they're accustomed to Oakland. It may be better.
It could be better than Oakland at this point, considering how bad that stadium is.
We heard stories of literal doo-doo floating down the halls there. Who was the catcher we signed from? Derek Norris years ago said that he was in the shower one time and a piece of turd washed up at his feet. That's a true story.
Bart, when the Chargers were here, like towards the end of their run here, like there were high schools with better facilities.
No doubt.
Football locker rooms, weight rooms, than what we had at Qualcomm Stadium. It was awful.
No question. So it may be better. They may love it. It may be a breath of fresh air. Turdless showers for everyone there in Sacramento. This is a really cool doo-doo this.
DD mega doo-doo.
Speaking of.
Yeah. Ricardo Pinto made his major league debut with the Phillies in 2017. Played in the minors for the White Sox, the Rays, the Giants, the Tigers. Pitched two innings for Tampa in 2019. Played in the KBO, the Chinese Professional Baseball League, and the Mexican League. Signed a deal in the offseason to return to the Phillies system. So he was in the minor leagues. They needed an arm. And they made the call to Rochester and said, "Send us Ricardo Pinto." They sent a car for him. About a 5.5-hour drive. The traffic apparently was murder. And he's in the car. Now imagine this. You haven't thrown a
stressing
in,
out
in a
bit.
Big league game since 2019. And they you get the call and you're like, yes. All right, just gotta get to the ballpark and then, you know, get my uniform and everything else. Traffic. Sitting, rotting in traffic. And he didn't get there until the fourth inning. So he was, you know, sitting in this car on the 81, I guess, gets to the field, throws a few down in the tunnel, gets the old whip loose. And then the phone rings and says, give us Pinto. Goes in in the sixth inning. Phil's holding onto a 2-1 lead. 7-plus hours in the car, making his first MLB appearance after running straight from the parking lot, essentially. Four innings, four strikeouts. Gave up a run in the eighth after an Alec Boehm error. Then gave up two runs in the ninth. Bryce Harper hits a grand slam, throws a five spot up. He goes out, gets the last three outs, gets the four-inning save. After 7-plus hours in the car, I mean, a whirlwind awesome. Day for Ricardo Pinto yesterday. I mean, and again, it's one of those things where, like, appreciate the very well today. You could see his name on the we have optioned Ricardo Pinto back to Rochester.
Almost certainly
after coming in and wearing
he's useless
it.
After throwing four innings.
That's exactly so. Right. So, but that's what a story
that's cool.
for him. That's really, really cool. And he just said, I'm just going to game this up. I'm going to take every chance with my opportunity here and knock it out of the park, and he did.
And that's Don't and Do This for a Thursday.
That was Don't Do This with Ben and Woods on 97.3 The Fan.
Marco in the chat says, did they cover the Soto story yet? No, Marco, we have not, but we're about to. The Athletic with some details on Juan Soto's exit from the San Diego Padres, his time here, the struggles, the highs and the lows, an interesting piece that there's some divergent opinions on as well about the former Padres slugger. We will get into that story coming up next with Ben and Woods on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. Sour 97.3 The Fan is brought to you by Prize Picks. It's America's number one fantasy sports app. Cash in on basketball's big moments with Prize Picks. Use code KWFN for a first deposit match of up to $100. Prize Picks. Pick more, pick less. It's that easy. Just following up on Don't Do This, Kyle in our chat about the A's potential move to Sacramento that could be announced in the next day or so. Kyle says Sacramento is a big sports town, similar to San Diego, and the fact that it's only had the Kings, it'll be great for the people there to support the A's. Will it? If you are a Sacramento baseball fan, and let's say you've been going to Rivercats games, you've enjoyed the AAA games for a long time, are you just immediately going, yeah, I'm all in. We get a Major League Baseball team for 3 years. I'm going to be a season ticket holder while they're here, knowing they're going to leave you in 3 years. And also that they're now competing with the team that was your team, the Rivercats, playing in the same ballpark and eating up half of the dates and some of the oxygen from the city. Is that a good thing to rent a Major League Baseball team for 3 years or not?
I think you're just excited, like, oh, the Mariners are in town. We got nothing to do this weekend. Let's go watch Julio Rodriguez. Oh, the Angels are in
town.
Give
me a chance to watch.
We'll go watch Mike Trout.
But you also know that you're supporting an owner who just ripped his team away from their city, very sadly, and that people are, you know, not too fond of. So do you want to go buy tickets for that team while they're there?
It's like Paulie said, to go see Fernando Tatis Jr. or Julio Rodriguez. Yeah, I mean, I think so. And look,
don't
I mean,
have to drive all the way to the Bay now.
If we didn't support awful people, we wouldn't support anyone at the end of the day. It sucks. I mean, it is what it is. Anything that goes in his pocket sucks, absolutely. And I totally understand why people are like, no, they've lost me forever. I'm not going to follow them to Oakland. We know it all too well here in San Diego, certainly. And some people make the choice to do it. Some people don't, and that's okay. I do think it'd be cool, though. Like, and even though you know well, it's just a temporary place, I mean, it's interesting. At a bare minimum, it's very, very interesting to see, oh, cool, you guys are a big league team playing in a minor league ballpark and rotating nights with the minor league team or however they're going to do it logistically. Sounds like an absolute effing nightmare for whoever logistically has to do this. And I know who it won't be. It won't be John Fisher. He's not going to be the one doing the logistics. He'll be sitting up, you know, working out deals in Vegas and everything else. It really is a crap look for Major League Baseball and a series of crap looks for Major League Baseball lately.
And remember, if you were a Rivercats fan, you've probably been following the Giants. People in the chat pointing out, Sacramento's a Giants town.
It's crazy.
You know, the lines are drawn. Giants or A's. You're rarely a fan of both, just like Yankees or Mets.
Aren't you then mad at your owner
giving them?
Dude, is letting his buddy... you know, I mean, I know you'd let Dave Roberts crash on your couch, but I wouldn't.
Ben, you do a great job.
I think the fans there are like, oh, really? Okay. And now you got to share your ballpark. I don't know. I mean, it's going to be interesting how it plays out. It's terrible. It's heartbreaking for the A's fans, all of it. We've talked about it, you know, ad nauseum. Like, it's a terrible look and it's so haphazard. It is me doing a project in eighth grade. On the night before it was due, a science project of like, what can I do? That's how this whole thing has felt, you know, and rubber stamped all every step of the way. So, sounds good. Do you have a plan? It doesn't matter. Stamp it, run it through, we'll figure it out as we go. I've never seen a more haphazard scene out of Major League Baseball.
No, and people pointing out it's only a 10,000-seat ballpark.
But of course, the A's don't need 300 people now.
That many seats to begin with. So, you know, maybe you'd rather have a smaller park that looks somewhat full as opposed to a big park that no one's there at.
Now, my boy Alex in the chat says Rivercats used to be an A's affiliate. So maybe the old heads are like, well, this is my team. Yeah, I don't know.
So stupid, man.
It just sucks. And like... John Fisher's going to get the last laugh.
Yeah, they always do.
I do know that Vivek, the guy who owns the Kings, sees this as, hey, I want to be on the list for an expansion team.
Sure.
And if we show well, then maybe Major League Baseball will put us on the short list to get a real team if we can support the A's and do a good job over the next 3 years and get a stadium built. So that's part of the equation
there as well. Makes sense.
Not official, but reports out that could be announced today or tomorrow. All right, let's check traffic. I want to get into the Juan Soto piece that Britt Giroli dropped on The Athletic yesterday. And I know Woods is Some people were upset with some of the comments and the portrayal of Juan Soto when he was with the Padres. Woods is going to push back a little bit, he said. Get to that next year on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danick.
Some very tough traffic out of Lemon Grove this morning, all due to this fatal motorcycle accident westbound King Freeway before Federal. Two left lanes remain blocked for at least another hour, so plan around that. Give yourself plenty of extra time. Consider taking West 8 or surface streets to work your way around that. That's westbound King Freeway just before Federal. Also an accident northbound 125 before the 8. It's over to the right shoulder. I'm Kelly Danick with Ben and Woods, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
There's some good details in this athletic piece by Britt Giroli about Juan Soto. Some things that we already either knew or suspected. And one thing that was confirmed to me is that Juan Soto still romanticizes his time with the Washington Nationals, especially the World Series year. And he's kind of he compares everything to that family, that team, those guys. And it's almost like he's stuck in that moment of time. And after, a number of those players, Bryce Harper left, it wasn't the same there, but it also wasn't the same in San Diego. That was totally different. And he continues to compare everything to kind of how he viewed things as a young rookie, first-year, second-year player going to a World Series, and continues to seemingly be disappointed in the rest of his experiences in baseball that don't match up to that.
And that happens. I mean, I think that happens with relationships. I think it happens with friendships. I think it happens with jobs, certainly. He's not immune to those feelings, certainly. What about the article? Did you read the article? Yeah, suspicions confirmed about Juan Soto. Because, listen, no one can deny the production, right? And I know it wasn't what many people thought it would be. That being said, it was the best that we had by far last season, certainly. And I saw people like, "Ooh, I'm so glad we got rid of this rat," and I'm reading it and I read it again and I went, "Rat, okay, that's a little harsh. Oh, what a selfish player he is." And I said, "Okay, all right. I'm gonna process this." What in particular did you look at and say, "Ooh, yeah, the rumors are true"?
Well, there was a quote, and again, I did not come away from reading this piece thinking Scumbag. Juan Soto was a bad guy right. at all. But there was a quote that, and it was from I think a Padres source that said he just has trouble trusting people. He's got a heart of gold. He just has trouble trusting people.
And that's a flaw.
What's wrong with that?
That's not a flaw.
It's not.
I have trouble trusting people.
But the Padres,
from
their perspective.
you need more trouble.
I need more.
It sounds like the Padres were tearing their hair out, trying to find ways to connect with him, trying different strategies to make him feel comfortable. Everything they could. Roll out the red carpet.
Sure.
We want you to feel as much a part of this team. We want you to be our guy. And it sounds like they really spent a lot of time trying to make it work well with Juan Soto, and he was resistive to ever kind of letting himself fully become a member of the San Diego Padres team. I understand. Yeah, I get that, Paul. It is hard for people to trust.
But I also think, just having a conversation here, that's a kid. He's a 24 right now, I believe, right? 24 years old?
I think so.
25. Yeah.
So he's very young, been in the game for a while.
He was 24 with us.
24
he
with us.
Turned 25 in October.
Okay. So, to your point, Ben, there was a quote in there about, man, I don't think they have money for me here. So
there's no money for me here.
So he
saw the other contracts.
Sure.
And Tatis, Machado, Bogarts. There's no money for me here.
And so what about that statement is wrong? What about that statement?
Why don't Peter Seidler always said, I want Soto to be on my team.
Absolutely. And when Peter, got ill, fell ill, I think it hits home a little bit. And you're like, they're not going to keep me. So, again, you've been traded from the Nationals. You did turn down a big contract because you didn't want to stay through a massive rebuild, even for that amount of money. And you get traded. Again, he didn't choose to sign. He was traded here. He had to reassimilate and all that. Was paid handsomely. So I hear what you're saying out there. The knock on him as a selfish player is one that is interesting to me. I know Fernando Tatis Jr. and he are very tight. They love each other very much, and they liked playing together. Manny had some nice things to say about him. Do I feel like Juan Soto maybe sucked some air out of the locker room? Sure, I do. Do I also feel like Michael Jordan probably did the same? Yeah. Tom Brady, guys of that ilk? Sure, absolutely. What he did, though, like a selfish player, he played 162 games. He played every single game for the San Diego Padres last year. He led us in almost every offensive category, and by like a good measure. He produced when he was here, but he also knew they're not going to keep me. So some guys will say, well, they're not going to keep me. I'm not going to give my best effort. He gave his best effort in the fact that he led this team in everything. In everything. Games played. I mean, a few guys had a couple more hits than him, but home runs, RBI,
posted,
OPS.
Yeah, 162 games last year. Yeah, I don't think that Juan Soto was giving less than his best for the Padres. I do believe he never considered the real possibility that this might be his new home.
Well, because the writing was on the wall of like, how do you get settled if you don't, like, I'm not going to come here and work on a 6-month contract, right? I like it. It's great. But I also have a family to take care of, and I have a future to think about. And they do mention in the article, look at who his agent is. 50 meetings with his agent, Scott Boras, about...
Yeah, and the one quote from a Padres source is he's been fully Borasized.
Which, by the way, have we ever heard of a young player from another country being exploited ever? Is that, I mean, we're acting like that doesn't happen. And it absolutely does and has and will continue.
So here's where, and I think I saw at least a couple of people, maybe a Friar aficionado, pointing out on Twitter. The disconnect here, though, that one thing that was pointed out, Juan Soto loved being on the East Coast, a little closer to his family.
Yeah.
That they could come out. He was homesick. He kind of always wanted to get back to the East Coast.
Again, that's nothing wrong with that.
He got traded.
That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But he also, he turned down, you know, a lot of money with the Nationals because he felt like, and here's his quote. He says, you cannot be selfish. You have to think about the guys who come in behind you. That's what Judge did in opting to test free agency. He made a great deal. Basically, Juan Soto is saying, the way that I can be unselfish is by holding out for as much money as possible. And that's how I'm going to be unselfish and give back to the game and my fellow players is by sacrificing, by making sure that I make the absolute every last dollar I can possibly get.
That's a weird thing for us as fans and normal people without those types of salaries to wrap our heads around. But I buy that because you are raising the market for the future players in your game.
And it is true. It is true that you can't just have every player say, I'm just happy here. If every player was Tony Gwynn and took less than market value to be in their cities, players would be less well off today than so. There is that element to it. However, if your most noble act is holding out for as much money as possible, I don't know how unselfish that really is.
I don't know that he's presenting himself as noble necessarily.
He said, you can't be selfish. You really have to. You have to make sure you get the most money as possible because that's important for the game. You know, it's important for my fellow players.
Well, it is.
It's important for the fellow players. It's important for him. It's important for his family.
Do you know how many people in this dumb business have been massive scabs and been like, well, I'll do it for free or I'll do it for half? Like, it set us all back, right? It's a different business, but it's the same thing. I mean, yes, get paid. You're one of the best players in baseball. Why? I have no issue with that guy wanting to make money. None. That's what he does it for. I mean, I just listen. It's very there's a little bit of copium in there, I think, too. You lose a top producer like that, and it's like, whew, okay, I got to find a way to deal with this. I liked what we got back for him. I hope that it you know plays out in our favor, but.
There was also the implication, though, that he was blindsided by the Padres trading him, which is, if you're signaling to the Padres, I don't think you're going to sign me. I really like being on the East Coast.
You saw what they said.
You made it impossible for the Padres to keep you. You really almost did.
How did he make it impossible?
By telling the Padres in so many words, you have almost no chance of signing me as a free agent. So you are, if you keep me in 2024,
bro, we
you're
can't
lose
afford
me.
JD Martinez.
And you're going to lose me for nothing.
You think we could afford Juan Soto?
Well, no, I'm not saying that. But But then don't be surprised about it. You know, like, of course the Padres traded
his,
you.
His quote was, I kept asking, and they were saying, no, no, no. And then out of nowhere, it's done. He didn't say blindsided. He didn't say blindsided. He said, they kept saying, no, 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 you're here. And that was probably Peter.
Well, you're here. You have to say that.
You can't tell him, you're on the block.
Say, you know, well, we're going to try to trade you, but maybe we won't, and you'll still be a Padre next year. You're a Padre until you're not.
Right.
And then that's how trades work in Major League Baseball.
Yeah, I mean, and I saw a lot about the AirPods in meetings and things like that. And I kind of smart-assedly tweeted, oh, wait, Juan Soto didn't want to hear the hitting advice from Michael Berdar. Wow, what a jerk. Michael Berdar, he's not going to listen to him? Listen, man, it didn't work out. He's a Yankee. He's going to get paid. He's probably going to have a really good year. But characterizing him as some villain here, I thought was a little bit egregious. Did he produce like we all thought he would? Probably a little bit below our expectations, certainly, but there were some expectations that were through the roof, and those expectations exist for him always, and they always will. But I read that article, and I didn't come away. I don't think he's a victim either. I'm not like, oh, poor Juan, but I also feel like, hey, man, there's a couple different sides to this, and, you know, it's a hard thing to get traded, I would imagine, and be like, I don't know if they like want me, and I don't know if they can afford me. I know I only have a couple years left. I'm going to give it my best and try to earn the most money I can. And you know, a lot of people are ripping him for that. So I don't know, man. Time will tell with Juan Soto. I really enjoyed watching him play. I enjoy watching him hit. He's just one of the best hitters alive. I mean,
I wish him the best. When he goes to free agency and he gets his big contract, I certainly hope that whatever team he goes to for the next 12 years and get, you know, $800 million, whatever he's getting.
Yeah, whatever it is.
I hope he fully commits to them and is not talking about the great old days with the Washington Nationals.
But he might.
For the next decade with his new team.
He might.
That's all I'm saying.
He won a World Series there. That's where he started.
I get it. But when you're with that team and they're paying you that much, you got to buy in. Yeah. And I don't think he ever bought in.
I think there's room for both.
He bought in. You know how he bought in? He led our team in everything.
All right, we can continue this. Second half of Ben and Woods coming up next on the Fan.
All right, my friends, we are halfway home on a Thursday. Ben and Woods, 97.3, The Fan. And, yeah, just kind of discussing this whole Juan Soto thing. I don't know why, necessarily. It's just, you know, slow day. Padres won. Nice, you know, clung to victory yesterday. Won a one-run game. We can get back to some analysis of that. We got Eno Sarris coming up at 8:35. But I'm Woodsy. That's Paulie. That's Benny. And we're talking about it. And we did come to a point of agreement, I think, at the break of, you know, in this scenario, I do think a lot of the villain finger needs to point probably at Boras Corp and Scott Boras. And when that quote was interesting to me about he's been fully Borasized, which, again, I mean, you're talking about a young kid that sees the potential of Scott Boras advising him to turn down 440 if he really wanted to stay in Washington, where he had bought a home, was comfortable, close to his family. That's just bad advice, in my opinion. And he's not the first athlete to get or receive.
Like they offered him 140.
Right, right. He's not the first athlete to get bad advice and also take said bad advice.
I think Juan Soto's not the villain here. And I'm sure that there are many players who will always thank Scott Boras for pushing the market as he has done over the years. But if you look at the last 24 months less, you know, Scott Boras's clients, I don't know that they've been that well served.
This year's been awful.
Starting with Juan Soto, who clearly has been told by his agent, you have to hold out for free agency. All of his quotes, like when he went to the Yankees and the reporters immediately asked him, hey, are you going to talk about a contract extension? The Yankees know who to talk to. It's all about Boras when it comes to Juan Soto. He's fully bought in. Boras has told him, hey, we've got to set the new market. Is that really serving your client, though? Or is that serving
yourself,
you as an agent?
Yeah.
And maybe baseball players as a whole will benefit, as Juan pointed out. But isn't ultimately your biggest job as an agent is to give your client the most satisfaction out of his career, which includes money? But if your client is going to be happier in Washington, you can't force him to have to go to free agency if that's not truly what he wants. If that's where he wanted to be, and you told him, you have to turn down this 440 because we're going to get more than this. There's too much deferred. This is not good for the game. But I kind of want to be here. It sounds like that very much was the case. And now look at Scott Boras's current clients. The ones who have opted out and gotten less. The ones who were expecting huge deals, multi-year deals, like Blake Snell and Jordan Montgomery this offseason and Cody Bellinger, and who are all just taking one-year deals with options. Prove it again. You know, Scott Boras, I would assume, has had to do some explaining to some of his clients in meetings here about what has gone on this offseason. And I'm sure he's railing about the owners and the market, and collusion probably has come out of his lips behind closed doors at some point. They just hate me and whatever. But it doesn't seem like his clients are thriving the way that they used to be thriving in Major League Baseball.
No, definitely not. And you know, to talk about some of the things about Juan Soto that I think have been blown a little bit out of proportion. He was late to a bus. I did hear that. Wow. Whew. It's not the first time that's happened. It's not the last time it will happen. That stuff happens. And I'm not a late guy. I don't like being late. I think it's disrespectful. Who the hell knows what went on when he was late to the bus? Certainly not a hanging offense, right? The AirPod thing, somebody had just commented about that.
And I heard it was one time.
Right,
like, it was not like every single time we're trying to go to the airport, waiting for 20 minutes because Soto's not ready.
So the headphones thing, or headphones. So, again, they talked about it in the article. They would go and give tips about tells and things like that. Okay, so when Bumgarner digs in, he may be thrown and Juan was like,
hitters meetings at the beginning of every series.
Yeah, he goes, I don't want to hear this. This is not beneficial to me. It is detrimental. I don't hit that way. I don't look for where his glove is. I look for what I look for that's allowed me to be one of the most successful hitters. It's his process, right? Is that the right way to handle it? Probably not. To just be like, la, 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 right?
You want to address that with the coaches beforehand and go, yeah, I'll step in, do a different sort of meeting. Now that could also, well, he didn't show up to hitters meetings. That could bother people as well.
Right. He was. He is.
Kind of a lose-lose situation, but I totally get it. He, whatever he's been doing, it's been working just fine for him.
Yeah.
His processes that you just mentioned. And yeah, I don't, like, he doesn't want a bunch of different voices in his head when he's up to bat.
I can totally.
You have a blink of an eye.
I can totally relate to it. I really can relate to it. Now, JD says, no I in team. Okay, fine. I get it. We all want that. We all want to think of our favorite players and ball clubs as 26 angels that are all willing to die for the team. We want that. That's what the sports fan dreams of. It's not rooted in reality, in my opinion. And that goes from Little League to the majors in football and basketball and hockey and everything else. It really. I mean, we want that. That's altruistic, though. It doesn't make sense, and that's not the way of the real world. And if you think that it is, I would say you're a little bit naive, right? There are teams that do it better than others, certainly. We haven't been good at it. There hasn't really felt like a good chemistry here for a while. Who knows what to put your finger on, right? If you're going to paint him as the issue with the San Diego Padres, okay, that's your prerogative to do so. I disagree vehemently. And again,
I think a lot of people had, like, Soto was kind of backed into a corner in the eyes of some some faction of the fan base.
Sure.
Here.
And he already is in New York too.
Right.
Already, it's been eight days.
I don't get it personally. I think it's kind of weird. Like, the fact that literally his entire time here, we had to sell Juan Soto and you know, I'm still upset we traded him. Like, he's a generational player. I want those guys on my team, especially when they lead your offense in every category, finish top 5, top 10 in MVP voting. But he was kind of doomed from the beginning. Like, people were, like, criticizing whatever they could find
from day one,
whether it was a walk or his defense, yeah, or whatever.
It may have been. But, you know, as I was talking to Paulie about this yesterday, and I said, and Paulie made the good point. He goes, you know how, like, we have audio on the show, and I'm like, hey, I want you to hear the audio, Woodsy. I'm like, I don't want it. I want to hear it on the air.
No, this would be good for you. Like,
No, we're
going to play this on the show. You're going to hear it. Like, I need you to hear it now.
Nope, don't want to. Don't send it to me. I will hear it live tomorrow. That's my process. That's what has worked for me.
All right, well, then I guess put in your headphones. I'm going to play it for Ben.
It doesn't mean I'm lazy. It doesn't mean I don't care. It means it works for me. And somebody says I'm the Soto apologist. I'm not being an apologist. He's gone. He's not coming back. They're not going to go after him in the offseason. They're just not. They can't afford to.
Being an apologist would imply that Soto did something wrong.
Correct.
And it's hard to say that Juan Soto did anything wrong.
There are people out there that do think he was selfish.
Finished sixth in the MVP voting last year. Had a terrific year. Now, he didn't have a great rest of 2022 when they acquired him, but as was pointed out, and we're talking about Britt Giroldi's piece in The Athletic, he was already kind of slumping in 2022 with the Nationals when they traded him. It was just his worst season all around, and that did continue with the Padres. He did end up getting
some big hits in the playoffs.
He did get some big hits in the playoffs as well.
25 years.
So there's nothing that he really did wrong. Did the Padres do something wrong? Now, it was also pointed out in this piece that when they traded for Juan Soto, the Yankees went out and hired the former assistant hitting coach for the Washington Nationals, a guy they knew that Juan Soto was comfortable with. And it was pointed out that Juan was never really comfortable with the hitting coaches that he had here in San Diego.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's been an issue with the Padres before. But you could have gone out and tried to, you know, maybe make him more comfortable with your hires. But that also comes with a potential drawback. When you're seen as catering to one player, the other players look at that and go, well, why aren't you hiring, you know, my guys as coaches? Right. You know, Manny,
lots more Orioles coach out there.
They did that for Manny, and I don't know that it went that well in that situation either. So there's a pro and con to all of it, but it is a fascinating, it's definitely a fascinating glimpse that you can draw many different types of conclusions about Juan Soto from Britt Giroldi's piece in The Athletic.
Yeah, it's tough because, you know, when you're talking about a team, like I said, you do want to get the image in your head of 26 guys all out at a restaurant together and pulling on the same rope. It's great. That's the dream. If you could draw it up in the lab, that's what you would have. But it was tough. There was a lot of power struggles last year, right? And Xander even spoke about it, and Manny had to go to Xander and say, hey, dude, speak up, man. I need you. You know, and he's like, oh, I'm cool to do that? Okay, great. Leadership's tough, man. It's a tough thing to do. It's a tough thing to learn how to do. It's done in different ways. And for me, his production was the best we had. I covet players like him. Could he have done better? Yeah, he could have. He absolutely could have done better. But
he had more in there.
There's more in there.
Whether it's selfish or being a jerk or cocky or egotistical or any other word that you can come up with or a little bit of both, all of it, like every great has some of that in them.
No, they have to. They have to.
Maybe there's a little bit of disillusion.
Maybe not Tony Gwynn.
Tony Gwynn is the one.
Maybe not Tony Gwynn.
He might have been the only one,
right?
Quite frankly.
It's like the only one I can think of from everything I can put in my mind and put it together.
Padre. He's beloved in this city for millions of reasons. And maybe there's a little bit of disillusion there because if you were to, you know, no matter the sport, whether it's Juan Soto, Michael Jordan, LeBron James, Tom Brady. There's a little bit of jerk in all of them. Like, there's a little bit of they're hard to deal with.
Paul, are you saying we shouldn't compare everyone on the pedestal of Tony Gwynn?
I don't think you should compare anybody.
Yeah, he kind of stands alone. Yeah. Really? I mean, truly.
Not a single person.
I mean, JD says... JD says in the chat, the Padres tried to work with Soto. Not sure I can say Soto tried for SD. That's the point that makes me want to ram my head into a wall. He played 162 games. He led your team in every offensive category, but triples and singles, maybe. How do you honestly say you didn't try here? My buddy Mike, who I love on Twitter yesterday, he goes, I just saw too many selfish at bats. And that one like made me do a backflip in anger. And I'm like, selfish?
What's a selfish at bat?
I'm like, oh my God, the dude, I want him to be more selfish. He's in a, you know, he's got an opportunity to drive in runs. He took a walk. It drove me crazy at times. I'm like, do damage, bro. He's not going to swing outside of the zone very often, like the lowest in baseball. That's the definition of unselfish. I'm not going to swing at a bad pitch and roll over hitting a double play, even though he did hit into some double plays, as they all do. I saw a guy that went up there and grinded out however many at-bats he had to the best of his ability and put up the best numbers we had, right?
I don't disagree with that.
Do you think he took selfish ABs?
I don't know. I don't even know what a selfish AB is. In a game where it always helps your team to get on base... The walk is never a selfish thing. I know some people will say, well, they need a run driven in that situation. But it's never really a good thing to expand your zone and swing at a bad pitch. That's how you make bad outs. That's even more selfish. To try to drive in a run and you swing at a bad pitch because you're so desperate right. for an RBI is more selfish
is.
Than taking the walk that is being given to you by the pitcher.
Taking a daddy hack on a 3-2 well, fastball at your eyes.
And Andrew says it doesn't have to be exclusively good for the team. It could be for personal benefit too. And didn't he play 162 to raise his stock? Yes. Yes. There's nothing wrong with that. Like... My goal is to play 162 games this year.
My goal is to do my job very well so that when my contract's up, I get a better
right.
deal.
Everybody out there that has a job, you know, you're like, I want to put in some good work so that maybe I can make some more money. I don't understand why it's different with him. I really don't. And he's gone, and he probably was never going to stay, but we will never know.
All right, we got to take a timeout, probably change the subject. I do want to point out, though, that someone who was probably instrumental in the acquisition of Juan Soto and so many other moves for the San Diego Padres stepped away from the organization yesterday. We'll talk about that when we come back. Maybe a little more on yesterday's game as well before we move forward. Don't go anywhere. Bennett Woods back after a check of traffic here on 97.3 The Fan. Padres said goodbye to a member of the family yesterday. Welcome back. It's Ben and Woods. Going until 10 o'clock, and then don't forget our roundtable, Padres Roundtable, with Gwynn and Chris and Annie and Elston coming in. Commercial-free from 10 to 11 o'clock this morning. Mike Shildt announced it in his post-game press conference that Assistant General Manager Fred Uhlman Jr., who is the longest-tenured member of the organization, having spent the last 29 years with the San Diego Padres, submitted his resignation. And Fred, do you know Fred at all?
I think I've met him one time, at like in passing at a Padres
that's
game.
That's almost shocking that you have.
I know.
Fred is as behind the scenes get. I used to see him a lot back in the early days when Kevin Towers was general manager. Fred was also his assistant GM. And they used to walk around a lot together, you know, kind of just shooting the breeze and talking all the time. And I got to know Fred a little bit. Bald head, you know. Just, you probably have seen him and didn't know who he was in the Padres organization over the time. But I never totally understood Freddie, because baseball is a game filled with a lot of egos, and people have their guys. And when organizations change managers, the coaches change. And when GMs change, all the assistant GMs and scouts, they all come in.
Yeah.
But Freddie was always there. He was an assistant GM under Randy Smith, Kevin Towers, Jed Hoyer, Josh Burns, and for the last 10 years under A.J. Preller. He just stuck around. He was the institution. He was...
That means you're good at your job, they don't want to lose you.
Exactly. And he knew the ins and outs of the business, of the organization. A.J. said, yeah, I mean, I relied on Freddie a lot, especially in the early years, you know, all of his knowledge and contracts and scouting and just every part of the GM game he's had a hand in over the years. So I wanted to make sure... Give him a little shout out. He never likes doing. I tried to interview him so many times. He always says, "No, I don't want to. I don't want to talk in the air. I don't want just absolutely
How about
not.
Now? How about now?
I don't know.
You're going to do this.
Maybe he'll change his mind now that he's out of the organization. But he was going to step away a while ago, I guess. And they wanted him to keep working. He said, "Okay, I'll get you through opening day." And then quietly, hopefully, I'll step away here, and no one will even notice I was gone. That's Freddie for you.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to say something and wish him the absolute best as he goes on, probably to even more anonymity, if that's what he really desires. But a really good guy. I always enjoyed it when I did get a chance to talk to him, run into him at the ballpark and say hello. He also is part of one of the great Ricky Henderson stories. And I have no idea, because some of these Ricky Henderson stories tend to be exaggerated and untrue. But as I've heard it told, so when Kevin Towers was the GM and he and Fred were always together, you know, before or after the game, walking in the hallways, people would, you know, shout and say hi and go, hey, KT, you know, that was Kevin Towers' nickname. But Ricky knew Kevin Towers as Kevin. So apparently for the entire time that Ricky Henderson was a member of the Padres, he thought Kevin Towers was Kevin Towers, and Fred must be the KT that they kept.
God, I love Ricky Henderson.
They kept saluting and saying hello to. So he thought, oh, this must be KT. KT, KT, how you doing? My name's Fred.
I'm Fred.
I could do a whole 4-hour show
just
with
Ricky
guests
stories.
Telling Ricky Henderson stories. It would never get old.
We had one. Somebody we interviewed let Ricky stay at his house. And I can't for the life of me remember.
The home run leader, 98.
Vaughn. Greg Vaughn.
Thank you.
Told the story.
Greg Vaughn.
I can't remember what he said, but he said he let Ricky stay
the
in
guest
like,
house.
The guest house in the back. He goes, it was an experience, to say the least. One of the most enigmatic players of all time, the great Ricky Henderson. Padre great. He was amazing. And you don't know. Half of them are urban legend. You know, really. Like, you don't know what's real and what's not. Like, Yogi Berra, it's the same thing. Like, those players are my favorite guys.
Now, Mike Shildt mentioned Fred Uhlman resignation. Now, I don't know if he said, I like Freddie. But at the end of the show yesterday, we were playing some Mike Shildt audio.
Yes.
I had a homework assignment today.
And we realized that Shilty and yours truly.
Yes.
Have a similar quirk and tendency to list off things that that we like.
We played a clip. It was actually the clip that, yeah. It was about 90 seconds, two answers from Mike Schilt. And in the 90 seconds, I pulled six things Schilt likes. And so
that's more than 10% of the way to an entire segment, yeah. Like we do for me.
I just like the way the lineup flows. I like continuity.
So do you.
I like him in the leadoff spot.
That's incredible.
I like the fact that he takes good at bats. I like the fact that we've had some production at the bottom of the order.
I'm so happy for this.
I've liked a lot about Xander leading off.
Those were all from the same
You guys
clip.
Are twins. It's with the same intonation, the same... I like Xander. It is unbelievable.
I knew I liked Mike Schilt.
It's so good.
So, like... We need help. I need to, like, enlist the help of Dennis Lynn, Sam Levitt, people that are covering the team on a daily basis and asking these. We get Mike Schilt every Friday.
You got to lead him a little bit.
I need your guys' help.
I can't tell him.
No, I just need you to, like, bait him into saying things that he likes.
If he says it on our show, I'm going to pee my pants.
And if
laughing.
You do hear it, make sure we're alerted to it.
Correct.
You know, because there's a... There's a lot of manager audio every single day, before the game, after the game, interviews on MLB
Network.
We're
going to have to listen to every post-game press conference in its entirety now every morning because I got to hear more things that Schilt like.
I want him again, please.
I've liked a lot about Xander leading off. I like the fact that we've had some production at the bottom of the order.
Yeah.
I like the fact that he takes good at-bats. I like him in the leadoff spot. I like continuity. I just like the way the lineup flows.
Like, dude, when I put that together, I just know it. I will laugh so
Can
hard.
Can you do Mike v. Ben?
I could.
Like before the end of the show, just a few, you know, just a
oh,
few
yeah.
rotate, you know, like sparring.
I'll have it.
Left from Ben, right from Schilt. Left from Ben.
What do they
right.
call that when two rappers go back
oh,
and forth?
Oh, like a rap battle.
Yeah, like a rap battle.
A rap
a
battle.
Like battle.
Oh, my
I'll
God.
Have I'll have it. After Eno Sarris joins
okay,
us in
perfect.
Our next segment.
Perfect.
Are you kidding me? Come on.
That is so effing good. I can't stand it. And you can see the light bulb come on. We were all like, "Does he? He did. He did it again. Oh, my God, he did it again. I didn't know there were six. I thought there were three. Holy crap, dude. This is the best day ever. The best day ever. All right, let's go to break. We'll talk to Eno, and Paulie will work on the... Schilt v. Ben.
I definitely have
battle.
A good head start here, but he's catching up rather quickly at that pace.
Who wins at
he
the
can
end
drop
of the
in six in just six? One in just like one answer or two answers during a pregame
I feel like
scrum. I am
you're
going
screwed.
To get lapped here
you're
pretty
get
soon.
Killed.
I'm going to start
like
thinking about more things that I like.
Just like I like sandwiches. I like pennants. I like bottles. I mean, it's wild. Six. That was brilliant.
I like that Eno Sarris is coming up next here with Ben and Woods. Don't go away. Smart baseball ahead on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fam. Gotta, again, thank The Athletic for the great content this morning. Have the piece from Dennis Lynn and Ken Rosenthal discussing the Marlins, the Padres, trade rumors, trade offers that were made during spring training, Luis Arraez. Then we had the Britt Giroli piece on Juan Soto that provided a lot of discussion in our most recent two segments. And now coming up right after a check of traffic, our weekly smart baseball visit with The Athletic's Eno Sarris. They must be doing something right over there at The Athletic. We'll get to Eno right after this check of traffic on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danick.
Well, no change in the situation on westbound King Freeway. Just before Federal, two left lanes remain blocked, all due to a fatal motorcycle accident that happened a couple hours ago. So please give yourself extra time if that is your route. Consider taking surface streets or westbound 8 to get your way out of the East County. That's westbound King Freeway, just before Federal. Also got a crash on southbound 163 on the Genesee off-ramp. Traveling on the coastline, southbound 5, just before Poinsettia, a collision over the right shoulder. I'm Kelly Danick with Ben and Woods, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
Well, if we haven't named it by now, I don't think we ever are going to, so I just like to call it Smart Baseball. It is Eno Sarris' time to join us here on 97.3 The Fan. He was at Petco Park for a particular game on Tuesday when we happened to be throwing out the ceremonial first pitches. Did you guys see Eno?
Oh, yeah.
I did not get a chance to
I
see Eno before. This time. I hung out with him last time he was at Petco Park. I did not run into him this time, but it's good to have him back here with us on Ben and Woods. Good morning, Eno.
Hey, guys. I ran up to the front row to take video of you guys bouncing it, but unfortunately, it was pretty decent.
It was
It was pretty good, too, because Eno shot the video, and it was so good. I told it on the air yesterday how you go, all right, I'm here, and got the camera on the guys, and then we threw it, and you go, yeah. Just like that. Eh. Yeah. And it was so subtly brilliant. I wanted to thank you for that. And it was always great to see you. And when you're in town, you know, we always want to find out what delighted Eno Sarris about our fair city here in San Diego. I did see you post a picture of a sandwich, which is, you know, standard.
And that's, a beer.
And a beer. That's on brand. Crazy. Eno, yeah, staying on brand. Like Juan Soto in Walking. Eno Sarris, we've been talking about this all morning. It's driving me nuts. But yeah, so did you enjoy your trip?
Yeah, we're still here.
Oh, you're here?
I went to the game yesterday as well as a fan with the family and had those puesto tacos with the the fried cheese in them.
Yeah, queso burrito.
Yeah, I enjoy those. I don't know what's on the plan. I'm going to a show tonight, out in Ocean Beach and, probably going to Blind Tiger on Saturday night. Those are spots I like to hit up.
So yesterday's game was a bit of it wasn't the best baseball game in the history of baseball, but Padres won it, which to me was very different because they played a lot of those games last year, you know, 0 for 11 with runners in scoring position, you know, failing to capitalize on opportunities given to them by another pitcher. And then they went on and lost almost all of those games last year, but they did find a way to win that one somehow, some way yesterday. Your thoughts on that 3-2 non-memorable affair between the Cardinals and Padres?
Yeah, you know, I was thinking about it, like Victor Scott is probably like the fastest dude in the big leagues. You know, Brandon Crawford played last night, but usually they have Mason Wynn there. Him and Victor Scott both can like really throw in the 90s. I think Wynn can actually throw 100. You know, they're position players. They keep like turning out these interesting, Nolan Gorman hits the ball super hard. But their pitching is so terrible. It's just, it makes them a mediocre team. So, you know, when their pitching is good, they're hard to play. Yesterday, their pitching wasn't great. And they came out, the Padres came out on top. I liked that, Suarez for five outs was something that caught my eye too. I mean, I guess that he's healthy and they're ready to do that. It also speaks a little bit to the struggles we saw the night before from Yuki Matsui. And we've seen Wusuk go struggling too. So You know, they may be trying to figure out how that back end bullpen is going
to
work out.
You know, and I was talking to, it's funny you mentioned that, talking to Eno Sarris here on Ben and Woods. I was talking to Ruben Diablo a couple weeks ago, and I asked him straight up, I said, you know, I know it's player dependent and talent dependent and all that, but how long does it usually take to you know, see how it all shakes out? And you got to kind of try guys in weird spots and you don't use guys in weird spots. And he said, he goes, man, 2 weeks to a month, you know, he goes, really? And the players will kind of tell you where they slot in. It seems, though, with the pods, like, okay, this is what they're going to do and when. Like Wandy Peralta yesterday, perfect example. Great spot for Wandy Peralta to come in. Boom, dotted a guy. Boom, dotted another guy. And I'm like, all right, that's got to give Ruben Niebla and Mike Schilt a little pause about the next time they want to call on him in that inning.
Yeah, I think actually with metrics like stuff, I think it's even quicker than that. Although I will say it might be surprising to listeners that Yuki Matsui's stuff was above average. It won't be surprising to hear that his locations weren't. I think Wandy is like a really kind of an underrated reliever. That's just kind of done it over and over again. I expect him to get near the top, and you know, I love Jeremiah Estrada. You know, he's got to figure it out, the command bit out. He's optioned right now, but I think he'll be back and be in the back end of this rotation, of this bullpen. So, and I still have love for Morahan. So I think they've got some guys that might end up coming up to help. But right now, it looks like Suarez and Peralta are the guys that can get it done.
I don't know if his parents love him as much as Eno Sarris anymore. You love the stuff. What is it with him, do you think, with Morahone? I mean, is it
lefties are always a little more intriguing?
A little
right?
intriguing, yeah. Yeah. Is it the
velo from the left?
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty rare.
Yeah, it is.
You mentioned talking to Eno Sarris from The Athletic, Smart Baseball, and you mentioned the 5-out save from Robert Suarez. Caught Joe Musgrove's eye. He made a point of bringing it up, and we all kind of read it also as a backhanded shot at Josh Hader, who was definitely not a four or five out guy. He was just a 3-out guy last year. But as you've looked at it, in terms of effectiveness, you know, what are the kind of the risks of bringing in closers for more than the 3 outs? Do you tend to lose some of the specialness that makes the closer so dominant in the ninth inning when you keep going to him with 1 or 2 outs in the eighth inning?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's a couple pieces of research that come to mind. One is that basically for a reliever, every pitch they throw makes them worse over the course of the season. and so there is a real thing about saving your bullets. The other thing that I think of is just that the more outs you get from in one appearance, the more days he has to be down. And there's been a real sort of linear relationship between three-plus outings and days of rest that you can see across baseball. There have been back-to-back-to-backs, but those back-to-back-to-backs are not also, you know, four-out appearances. So, you know, Suarez would not be available today, you know, if there was a game. So I think that's a part of what you're doing is you're saying, okay, well, the schedule allows us to do this right now. But there are going to be lots of times when the schedule does not allow you to do it.
I'm talking to Eno Sarris here on Ben and Woods this morning. I've been this year, last year it was weird. I mean, I was so excited for the start of baseball season with all the guns that we had and all the bullets in the lineup, and kind of got off to a terrible start and it stayed terrible. This year I've been watching a lot more baseball. What's been your biggest surprise? I know that there's a couple of teams that have gotten out of the gate really, really hot in like the Pirates. I know who they've played. I understand all that. But you still got to win those baseball games. And what's been your biggest surprise so far at the early stages of this season?
You know, I really liked the Tigers and the Pirates coming into the season, but I didn't expect them to win out in their first series. So I expect them to, you know, be up and down over the course of the season as many young teams are. But those are two teams where there's a young core coming together. And one thing that I think you can see with the Orioles last year is that when you have a young core coming together, sometimes it comes like a year before you expect it. And so, you know, having them start so strong as they have, I think that's a good sign for them.
Now, the Tigers, the last unbeaten team, although they have to play twice this morning. You got a 9 o'clock game and a 12-10 game. So we'll see if they can hold that out through a doubleheader. Eno, I mentioned that piece that Dennis Lynn and Ken Rosenthal dropped, and I know you retweeted that. Any thoughts on whether the Padres should continue the pursuit of perhaps Luis Arraez? They still have, you know, we're told, a little flexibility under the luxury tax level. They still have a need for a designated hitter, apparently, when Manny Machado gets back to playing the field, which is supposed to happen later this month. He's taking grounders and throwing again. Is that a fit for the Padres,
you know,
in your
we're
mind?
We're still scarred from the Adam Frazier trade.
No, that didn't work
ago.
Out well.
Well, here's an interesting statistic. The Padres have the fifth best strikeout rate in baseball. You know, that's not necessarily an area they need to improve. But Dave Cameron was my boss at Fangraphs a while back. And one of the things he always said was, you don't necessarily always need to fixate on your weaknesses. You can make your strengths stronger. And putting Arraez on this team might make them one of the best two teams at making contact in the big leagues. And, you know, contrary to some of the other teams around there, like Cleveland is always the team that makes the most contact in baseball. You know, the Padres do have some power, so it's not like a Cleveland lineup. So, I was wondering, you know, I was watching this game, and I was wondering what's going to happen when Manny plays the field. Because they're going to have some choices to make with Rosario and Wade. And I think it would behoove the Padres to have somebody that had more of an offense-first profile than both of those guys. And so there's going to be a decision there, a roster decision. So there could be an opportunity to add someone that was more offense for a first there.
And clearly some of that improvement in contact rate is coming at the bottom of the order with Luis Campusano has been making good contact. Jackson Merrill as a 20-year-old with the good bat to ball skills that he has. But is that obviously making contact is better than striking out. But, you know, you want to make hard contact and get hits. How important is that contact rate? How much does it correlate to offensive success, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it is true. You know, for example, slugging correlates more with team success than on-base percentage. So that's been a thing that's actually changed a little in terms of the last few years. And then just on an individual level, yes, batted ball quality does have more to do with your overall production than the number of balls you put out there. However, like I said, pairing the two is great. And I talked to both Campusano and Merrill about their emerging power when I was in the clubhouse on Tuesday. And Campusano, I told him that he's hit a ball harder than he's ever hit it. And he knew exactly what ball I was talking about. It was the first ball in play of the year. He hit 110 plus. And he said, well, I'd rather have 70 mile an hour hits. So, I'll take the 110s, please. Because if you keep hitting at 110, you're gonna do fine. He also had some really interesting things to say about rhythm. You know how he has that crazy batting stance. And he said that basically, like, other hitters like to break their hands, like to time their swing to the pitchers breaking their hands.
Yeah.
And he says he likes to time his swing to their entire delivery. And so that standing open like that is, it gives him the opportunity to start moving towards a regular batting stance as they make their delivery. And that's actually a pretty smart thing to do, because pitchers will tell you something about the pitch they're throwing based on how their body is moving.
It's so fascinating.
Yeah, he was I only got a couple seconds with him, but I was blown away by some of the stuff he said. And then Jackson Merrill said, like, I'm a really handsy guy, and so, you know, I can make contact anytime I want. And so the things I need to do are swing better pitches that I can drive, and then also just stay back as long as possible. That'll allow me to kind of use my lower half better. And that's the kind of stuff you want to hear from a young guy that has that contact rate, and you're just like hoping they add that power level to it. I mean, that's the difference between an Arraez and a Jose Ramirez, right? They both are guys that can hit you a single anytime they want. But Jose Ramirez figured out how to tap into that 30 home run power.
Have you read, Eno, the MVP machine? I'm sure you have.
Yes, I have. I was very, very jealous of that book. I felt like I could have written it.
I feel like you absolutely could have and should have written it and maybe missed the boat on that. I
got a couple of texts from them while they were writing it, being like, can you stop writing for like a month?
Yeah, it makes sense. Well, and you know, some of the examples they use in the book, they're not the greatest, but they talk about Mookie and the work that he's put in to become, you know, more than just that slappy singles hitter and the guy that can steal bags. Justin Turner was another one that was a really fascinating one for me to read about in that book. And I was watching him last night with the Blue Jays. I was with my son watching the game. And, you know, the big high leg kick. And I'm teaching my kid about getting his foot down and, you know, using his lower half. He's 6 years old. He doesn't know what the hell I'm talking about. But I do find it still very interesting to hear from like Camposano talking about how he's completely reworked his swing. But you notice, too, with two strikes, completely different swing. Completely shortens up. You know, it's a really unselfish approach from him. It's really cool.
Yeah, I also was like, he chokes up on an axe bat, and axe bats were kind of made so you could hold them near the end of the knob and not hurt your wrist. And I was joking about that, and he said, no, the axe bat is made to feel good in your hands, and this is how it feels good in my hands. So he's an interesting character. And I just love this profile. I mean, somebody who makes this much contact and can hit the ball 110, that's somebody I'm looking for in a young player for sure.
Great stuff, as always. Eno, enjoy the rest of your trip here to San Diego. You say you're going to Blind Lady, right? We lost Tiger, unfortunately, but Blind Lady is still out there. Yeah,
I put two together there. Yeah, Blind Lady on Saturday.
All right, well, we'll have one for me, and safe travels back, and we'll talk to you again next Thursday.
All right, good to see you guys.
All right, Eno Sarris, Smart Baseball and The Athletic, brought to you each week by 7 Mile Casino, one of the great regulars in our lineup during baseball season. And, of course, tomorrow we've changed things up a little bit from last year, and now Fridays will be our day for the Cespedes Family Barbecue guys. And to kick off a new season, at 8 o'clock we'll have both Jordan and Jake from Cespedes Family Barbecue joining us at 8 o'clock tomorrow. And, of course, it's a Fryer Friday, which means our weekly conversations now with manager Mike Schilt at 9 o'clock tomorrow.
I hope he likes those, too. Did we have any audio from Schilty yesterday that we could...
I know he said some glowing things about Jake Cronenworth. Did he ever specifically say, I like Jake Cronenworth? I'm not sure if he did.
It's weird that he calls him the Crone Zone.
He said he wanted to take just a moment...
To shout out the Crone Zone?
To shout out the Crone Zone. Is the Crone Zone a person
it's
or
a place?
I think it's more of a place. Than
you
a person.
You can't hit it to the crony.
Goes to the crone zone.
Everybody is E. He said the other day, weighty.
Weighty?
Weighty. For Wade. Tyler Wade. Weighty.
What about pro? Pro's just pro.
Pro.
He's not pro E.
Profari.
Jury.
No. Jury?
The jury is in.
Well, I have the small sample size rap battle, things Schilt likes versus things Ben likes.
Oh.
Get to it right
save
after
that,
this.
By the way.
Tease
yeah,
that.
What the hell?
Excited for that.
Keep it in your pants, Ben.
This is like 8 Mile. This is Papa Doc again. Yeah. Have you seen 8 Mile?
No.
Sacrilege.
I know what it is.
Okay, I mean, yeah.
It's the Marshall Mathers movie.
It is. It's really good.
Next segment's a lot of Paul. We've got Paul's battle. We've got Paul's Reindl Report.
It's your battle,
it's
my
yours.
Friend.
Well, he put it together, though. He put it together. give Paul all the credit for the next segment. Coming up next with Bennett Woods on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. All right, no Padres game today. Okay, we are 1 hour away from our roundtable, though. Discuss the first week of the season. There is some baseball. In fact, there's a game starting in 10 minutes. Tigers at Mets. First game of the doubleheader after they had a rainout.
Mets won one yet or no?
The Mets, I believe, are still winless. Yeah, they have the rainout. And the Tigers are undefeated. So will it continue or will both teams finally go the other way in one of these two games? You've got a couple of former Padres pitching today as well. Ryan Weathers trying to get the Marlins into the win column. They will take on the St. Louis Cardinals in St. Louis. It's their home opener. I believe the Cardinals started on the road all week. So first game at home today for the St. Louis Cardinals this afternoon. And then Seth Lugo goes his second start for the Royals tonight. He went six shutout in his first, picking up where he left off with the San Diego Padres last season against the Chicago White Sox today at 4:40. But a very limited schedule, just 10 teams in action today in Major League Baseball.
Yeah, and as much as they're driving me crazy already, I'm going to miss the crap out of it today that it's not on, you know? Hate it. I hate off days.
All right, so Paulie was feverishly working during our last hour. After we discovered that Mike Schilt and I have the same tendency to like things in the exact same way, like Woods was kind of pointing out during the break, I said, doesn't everybody say, I like something like that? And Woods goes, no, I say it differently.
Yeah,
I just like the way the lineup flows.
That sounds like something Ben would say.
It does. 100%. I agree.
Mine is more like, I like that shirt.
Yeah.
Oh, I like that.
I go kind of, I register a higher octave.
Yeah.
I like rhubarb pie. And you kind of go down. I like that.
I like a small
Sounds
dairy.
Weird.
I like the fact that he takes good at bats.
Let's see.
So I put together, we had six drops from Mike Schilt. Just in that one clip yesterday, we will add to that, I'm sure. But just six from Schilt. So I took six from Ben. Kind of mashed it together with a little rap battle music behind it.
I just like the way the lineup flows.
I like Mexican food.
I like continuity.
I like rhubarb pie.
I like him in the leadoff spot.
I like pie gal poker.
I like the fact that he takes good at bats.
I like more of a small derriere.
I like the fact that we've had some production at the bottom of the order.
I like those little Smarties rolls.
I've liked a lot about Xander leading off.
I like how I've kind of set up my life. Round one.
I may need to hear it again to declare the winner. I think I just had a little pee dribble out. I'm not kidding.
I just like the way the lineup flows.
Yeah. I like Mexican food.
I like continuity.
I like rhubarb pie.
I like him in the leadoff spot.
I like pie gal poker.
I like the fact that he takes good at bats.
I like more of a small derriere.
I like the fact that we've had some production at the bottom of the order.
I like those little Smarties rolls.
I've liked a lot about Xander leading off.
I like how I've kind of set up my life.
Tears in my eyes. I'm going to go Benjamin with the victory.
Right. It's a long season, though. You know.
Oh, God.
Paulie, good job on that.
We don't tell him, right?
I don't think so.
No, we just let him. We just let
if he finds out, he finds out. He's going to find out from us.
God, he's going to be like, you sons of bitches, man. I just got here.
Or he plays along.
That is brilliant. Mm. Absolutely brilliant.
Right. If anybody hears things Schilt likes, let us know.
Please,
we're gonna need it.
Keep us in the loop on that one.
His press conference, his post game pressers usually go anywhere between 3 and 5 minutes.
Yeah.
We put about a 15 to 20 second clip at the end of our Padres wrap up every morning at 6:30. We may need to just play the whole damn press conference every single day,
just to be listening.
We have to. Somebody says maybe Schilt is doing a bit for Ben. That would be the next level.
That'd be unbelievable. I mean,
that's Andy Kaufman-esque if he's doing it. But that is like Borat. That would be brilliant.
Well, Mike Schilt will be on this radio program, on this radio station 24 hours from now.
This is his time slot on Friday.
That's right.
Right now, though, this is Paulie's time slot on the rest of the week.
And get things started here with our edition, today's edition of the Reindl Report.
Now tuned into the greatest.
Welcome to the Reindl Report
with Paul Reindl.
Hi, Paul.
All right.
Two stories from the world of sports that we haven't gotten to yet.
We'll start off in Major League Baseball.
And one story that you didn't know you needed.
Are you laughing, biatch?
It's the Reindl Report.
Hey, Paul, how you doing?
Okay, how are you?
On 97.3 The Fan.
Are you ready to bless the mood? I need some help, please.
That was good.
Can I get a yeah? Oh, yeah.
All right.
All right. Gentlemen, we will start off with big news, actually, this morning. Now, it's an update to an update, possibly to an update on beyond that. I'm not exactly sure. But earlier this morning during Don't Do This, we were talking about the Oakland A's and the idea of them possibly playing in Sacramento. And, well, about 20 or 30 minutes later, it became official. Reading here, there is a press release that was sent out. Sutter Health Park to host A's baseball. They will be playing in Sacramento starting next season, 2025. And then they're going to play there for three seasons with an option for a fourth if they need it before they move to Las Vegas.
So will they be called the Sacramento A's or still the Oakland A's or the Las Vegas A's? Have they
made that determination? I feel like once you leave Oakland...
Can't call it Oakland.
You can't call it Oakland.
But you're not in Vegas yet either.
But yeah, you're...
They didn't say that in the release, like what they're going to be referred to? Just the A's?
Interesting quandary. The A's.
They just see that. They say the A's.
The A's. The
like in the NL West or the AL West standings, it'll say
the A's,
Houston, Los Angeles, Seattle, S-E-A, Texas, and T-X, the A's.
A's. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, well, it's say SAC.
On the tickers.
Yeah.
Nothing in the press release here, but
curious about that one.
Official news.
So, just on a Padres related note. The A's come to San Diego this year, so the Padres have played their final game ever at the Coliseum.
Yes.
In Oakland. They will be going to Sacramento next season if the schedule remains consistent and alternating between years. Who knows? Maybe they'll even be the first team to go up there if they end up with an early season series for the A's home opener. It's certainly it's a possibility. Someone has to play an interleague game to start the year. Because there's an odd number of teams in each league. So, Padres Sacramento road trip 2025.
I'm gonna
can't
pass
wait
on that one.
Oh, really?
I will go to the
Don't
Vegas.
You care about state politics?
Not as much as I should,
right,
probably.
Yeah.
Have you been to Sacramento before?
Yes.
How is it as a capital?
It's pretty centrally located.
It is centrally located in the state of California.
I've driven through it.
Have you?
I've done the drive from Seattle to San Diego three times.
I flew there once for a wedding. Walked around the downtown area near kind of the state capitol buildings.
Okay.
It's rather flat and hot. It was the summer. It was very, very, very hot.
Sticky?
No, just hot.
All I know about Sacramento is that it is, in fact, our state's capital.
It is.
That my beloved Deftones are from there. That's what I know about Sacramento. Never been. Doubt I'll ever go. Certainly won't go up to see the A's play, but definitely will go to Vegas. That's the sad part. Is like I want to go to Vegas to see the Vegas A's. Guess who makes my money? John Fisher makes my money. Right. Sucks, but...
I'll give you the obvious take.
I've done worse.
Sacramento, it's no San Diego.
It's no San Diego.
Just give me that one.
Okay. I mean, I've been through there. I've gone to Chico a couple of times.
Yeah. Matt says Sacramento's great.
Okay, Matt.
Okay, Matt likes it.
On the drive down from Seattle, we got through Portland and parts of Oregon, and then you're on the 5 the whole...
Yeah.
The whole 23-hour drive. And once you get through like Portland and a little bit beyond that, you don't see buildings along that drive. Like nothing more than one story, like gas stations or Burger Kings. We get through Sacramento and my buddy and I were like, yes!
Yeah.
Civilization. And then you realize, Sacramento. And then there's nothing until like Bakersfield.
So this
is
fantastic.
I see this too. I know exactly what you're going to bring up.
Downtown Sacramento says Detlef Molt 2112. Downtown Sacramento is called Old Sac. And that's just fantastic. Agreed.
Are the A's going to be playing an old sack?
Agreed.
Or new
where
sack?
Will you be tonight?
Is that what it has in common with the YMCA?
Old sack.
To Woods?
Yes.
I'm going to Uptown Sack.
Okay.
All right.
Well. Old Sack.
A's will
what
be
part
there.
Of town do you live in? I live in Old Sack.
I believe the A's will be playing in West Sack.
Is that better than New Sack? New Sack's, well, that's creepy. Old Sack. I like Old Sack.
All right, we're going to move on.
The Old Sack Athletics. Oh. Done. That's sold. I would buy
old
a hat.
Old Sack A's.
The Old Sack A's. I'm in. Old Athletic Sacks.
In the NBA last night, tip of the cap to former San Diego State Aztec Malachi Flynn, who had 50 points last night for the Pistons in their loss to Atlanta. And
this is has to be the most random 50-point game in NBA history.
Yeah, I'd say so.
I mean,
most of the time, guys that score 50s are stars, and most of the time, stars are starters. Malachi Flynn is neither right now. He was coming off the bench, and he scored 50 points.
His previous career high was, I think, 27, so he nearly doubled his career high.
I didn't know he was throwing up that kind of numbers.
No,
though.
He's not. He's averaging about 5 points.
Okay,
per game.
All right. So, but
why he's coming off the bench?
He went off one night. He went off one night for 27.
18 for 25 from the field. Mom. Now, when you're the Detroit Pistons and you're horrifically bad, if someone wants to start shooting and they're hot, just let them at this point. I mean,
they are 13-63. Hmm.
They've lost 10 of 11, and it's not even close to their worst stretch of the season.
No, they started off like 0-30-something?
No, it was in the middle of the year. They had that two-month losing streak.
Period, yeah.
Anyways, it was only the third time that a player off the bench had scored 50 or more. And this is says since starters were first tracked in 1970 and 71 season. Jamal Crawford had 51 for Phoenix in a loss to Dallas back in 2019. And then before that, Nick Anderson had 50 for the Magic in their win against the New Jersey Nets in 1993. And then yesterday, Malachi Flynn. It never happened. Or
it's pretty amazing.
Only two times. Unbelievable.
Crazy.
And then finally, this was going around on our feed earlier this morning. I saw this. Thought you guys would be interested. Press Your Luck, the game show, has begun casting for season 6, which I had to remember. I go, season 6? It's the reboot, I guess.
Yeah,
not a
spin-off. The original was hosted by Peter Tamarkin. I used to watch that all the time. The new one, which
it's
you can see on ABC 10,
now.
Is hosted by Elizabeth Banks, the actress.
It was just delightful.
I like her. Mm. I like Elizabeth Banks very much.
I do too. So, yeah, they are looking for participants. They're casting nationwide, not just in L.A. or New York or wherever they film. I'm assuming they film in L.A.
I have already applied, my friends. I have been applying at commercial breaks all day. I just uploaded my two pictures. I've typed in all of the answers.
I didn't know you had to do photos.
The last step. Yeah, which is only going to hurt me. But the last step says here, step 36, by the way. We highly encourage you to upload a video of yourself. You can also make one here through our video recorder.
We have millions of videos of us that you can upload.
You do 4 hours of video.
Tell us your name,
day.
Age, city you live in, and occupation. Tell us why you would be perfect for the show. We love personality, so don't be afraid to be yourself and have fun. It sounds like a directive from our boss.
You're
Adam.
Not afraid to be yourself.
No, but
give me your best.
Make it your own.
Come on. Now, you know what they say when they're about to the spin. All right.
Hang on. No, I have to do the video. So my name's Steven Woods. I'm 48 years old. I live in San Diego, California. I'm a morning show radio host. Why I would be perfect for the show is I'm such a fun and fun-loving guy. I love fun. I never complain about anything. And,
you're boring me. Yeah. Next video. No, you need to stand out from the crowd.
Do what? Do a helicopter? My wiener? What do you want me to do?
No.
That would get them.
Just show that you're going to be an enthusiastic, fun contestant.
I don't really have
show a clip of you wiping out on Wipeout.
No, I told them in there. In the thing, they asked me if I'd ever been on a game show. I said, yeah. I said, I'd like to redeem myself.
Yeah, I like that. No, that's a good angle. Mm-hmm. Redeem yourself
from
Wipeout.
Maybe I'll put that in the video.
There's no threat to life or limb
Wipeout,
on Press
also,
Your Luck.
Also an ABC show, right?
The worst it was, yes. The worst thing that can happen to you on Press Your Luck is the whammy. So what do the contestants do? You're about to spin. The board is around.
No whammy, no whammy, no whammy, no whammy.
Stop!
Perfect.
Very good.
I love that
Big
show.
Bucks, Big bucks in a spin. People no whammies. No whammies. Stop.
Endorsements.
Now make it spooky.
Yeah, make it spooky. No whammies. No whammies.
On the Halloween episode.
Out your own spin on it.
Lance just crushed it with this one. He said, tell them you have a face for radio. That is.
You might want to shave. Well, maybe not.
That's just who I am.
Yeah. That could be a point against you, though.
Boy,
you want, well, it's
a beard?
It's network family friendly television. They don't want anyone who looks
scared. I don't have a needle hanging out of my arm. let me tie off real quick here. It's a beard. It's like, oh, this guy's a junkie. Next video.
Well, you want it to be a nice, you know, a well kempt then beard.
It's kempt enough.
Think Scott Lewis, voice of San Diego, more than you.
I can't grow one of like that. If I could, I would. I mean, I can't. This is what I get. It's sparse. And if I shave it down, it looks like I'm not allowed near schools. Like, it's terrible. I'm in a perpetual, what's the word I'm looking for? Between heaven and hell. Purgatory. I'm in beard purgatory at all times. It's terrible. Terrible.
Now, how do you think you do on the like the trivia questions where you earn the spins in the rounds?
I'm pretty good at trivia. Do you have some samples?
I was going to look and see if I could find some samples.
Let's
do a timeout. Yep. We'll do some sample press your luck questions to test Woods here.
You've just been called a beardist, by the way, in the chat. You are a massive beardist.
We'll get to that coming up. And then our Throwback Thursday sound that we've been looking forward to in our final segment all coming up. Don't go away. Be back after a check of traffic here on 97.3 The Fan. I spent the entire break looking for like sample press your luck questions to test you with, and I only found one online.
Well, and I haven't seen the new version.
So it's the same rules. You can either buzz in before they give you the multiple choice, and if you're correct, you get three spins.
Okay. Oh.
But if you wait for the multiple choice and you're correct, you only get one spin.
Got it.
And there's four questions. So theoretically, if you buzzed in every time and got every answer correct, you could get up to 12 spins
so
in the round.
Spins.
No one ever gets that many, though. Usually different people buzz in, someone gets them wrong, and generally, you know, someone will get four spins, someone will have five spins,
yeah.
Someone will have three spins, and then they'll go to the spinning round, which is what everyone's watching the game for.
Correct.
Anyway. They're not watching for trivia, but the one that I saw, and they were shocked because all three contestants, Billy, Janet, and Arnetta, failed to get it right. See if you can do this one. He won't make a rabbit disappear, but which former NBA's player's real first name is Irvin?
Magic Johnson.
See? There, you're already ahead of the game. Three spins for Woods.
Who is Babe Ruth?
What is a quince?
What is a quahog?
I mean, if you're going up against people who can't even get that, he won't make a rabbit disappear, but which former NBA player's real first name
is... Magic Johnson. That's how many spins for me? Four?
Three spins.
Fantastic.
And all you right. can win, I mean, you can really win an unlimited amount of money. You keep getting extra spins and avoiding the whammy. It just goes on forever.
It's
like
makes
the guy,
me sick.
The guy who figured out the board
yeah,
and knew
that.
When to stop it to get big bucks every time. It's one of the biggest scandals
yeah.
in game show history. Although he didn't do anything wrong. He was just smarter than the system.
Yeah, he's counting cards,
yeah.
basically. All right, so I do have to make my video. I'm going to do this, and hopefully I get picked. I don't know what to do on the video. I don't have a lot of fun and bubbly personality.
You should do the video on the air right now.
How do I do it? What do I do?
I mean,
you're on camera, so there you go. That's half the battle right there.
There's just we'll put there. A single shot on you. You got a selfie ring light there for good lighting.
Okay.
Got Adam in the background
running away as fast as possible. You want me to give you a big intro? Like here's ladies and gentlemen, with his Press Your Luck video interview montage, here is Stephen Woods.
My name is Stephen Woods. I'm from San Diego, California. I'm 48 years old, and I would really love to be on Press Your Luck. I embarrassed myself on a national stage and fell off the Iron Maiden on Wipeout, and I broke my ankle and got a concussion and had to be removed by the medical professionals, and they had to drag me out. And it was one of the more mortifying experiences in my life, and I would like the chance to redeem myself very much on your game show. And I think I would be fantastic at it.
You want to take out your frustrations on the whammy?
Very much so. Very, very much so. So that is my submission. I hope it's long enough, and I would love to see you guys soon.
All right, let's put him on.
Can you clip that for me? I got to attach it. I have no idea how to attach it. No.
I'll end up doing that too, I'm sure.
Yeah, you will.
PadreBot says, wait, you were on Wipeout? That really happened?
Shut up, dude.
I always love that we get new audience.
I know.
And we can tell this story every 6 to 8 months
it's
or so.
I bet you do enjoy my misery. It was...
Wipeout.
It's the worst day of my life. My buddy Jay, our buddy Jay Isbell. 50,000 as we're driving home.
You were way ahead. So you got to the final.
Yeah.
The final, what is it called? The big wipeout at the end.
Yes, that's exactly it. The big wipeout at the end.
Yeah. I had a name for it, but I can't remember what it was.
Driving home, I had vomited, by the way, because I was concussed. I fell all the way down the Iron Maiden.
So you were going second.
Yeah.
So the other team that qualified for the finals went first, and their time was like
horrible.
27 minutes.
I just basically just had to get through it, and we would have won.
Yeah.
I went the wrong way on the Iron Maiden. I was after the long 80-foot slide down
into
the freezing cold water.
That's like the Ferris wheel maze.
Yeah.
But you're supposed to ride it up to the top, and you kept going.
Yeah, I was going
the
against
way that was
dumping,
dumping you back down into the water.
I couldn't. My brain would not adjust, and I'm climbing, and there's no one there to like tell you, obviously. And I'm doing it, and I'm like, why can't I figure this out? And I get to the top. I ride it basically the top, and I just fall all the way down. Break my ankle, compression, like a compression break, back, whack my head, fall into the water, and they're like, go get him. And they pulled me out. I was like, ugh. It was terrible. It was the worst day of my life.
You told me now. I assumed that water was like clean pool water.
Oh, it's but disgusting.
It's, you said
freezing
it's not.
Cold. Freezing cold. And we're. I'm just like, I'm messed up, dude. My ankle's this big, black and blue. Driving home from, I can't remember, somewhere in L.A. Long drive home at like midnight. And we had a morning show the next day. And Jay's just driving 50,000 down the drain. 50,000. I told you to train, and you're fat, and you're lazy. 50,000. And I'm like, I'm so sorry, from the back seat.
Sorry, Jasper, it's community college for you.
Hey, listen, that's fine. Taking food out of my mouth, and Kim's mouth, and Jasper's mouth, and Maddie's mouth. I'm like, I'm so sorry, dude. I'm dying back here.
People want to know what season, what episode.
Doesn't
I
matter.
Know some people have found it. Yeah, some tier ones have found it before.
I actually don't have any of that really, the good footage in my archives of the show. I think that needs to be in there. Maybe even in a video you'd see during commercials here on Ben.
Yeah, I like that. I'd like that.
But I need the episode, and then it's tough because sometimes, like, when you like on Hulu or Max, you'll try to screen record during a show or a movie or something.
Can't do it.
Won't let you. So I need to.
You're good. Probably we don't need to. We don't need to. Because we don't. What we don't want to do is we don't want to open Pandora's box of this.
Jesus,
this is what we
season
don't.
Season 4, episode 23.
We don't want to do
four,
this.
Episode 23.
We don't want to do.
Let's see if I can find
We that. Don't want to open this Pandora's box. Should we? We have to tell them what we discovered this morning. If we're going to do this.
Oh, no. Should we do it next? We'll do it next.
Yeah.
We have our Throwback Thursday next.
This will be
won't take long.
This will be a Throwback Thursday for years to come. Wait, no, we're not. You were wrong. It's there.
I have to stick around for a roundtable today.
Oh, yeah, I can't see it.
Yeah, you couldn't see it. Never mind. You're good. You're off the hook.
Don't mess with me.
Yeah, I'm not going to.
All right. Throwback Thursday coming up next with Ben and Woods on San Diego's number one sports station.
Wipeout.
97.3 The Fam. Get a little update from Lindsay Adler. Tweets, the A's will not take a city moniker when they temporarily move to Sacramento. They will simply be the Athletics.
The Athletics. Okay.
So there will not be a Sacramento Athletics. They're not going to keep Oakland, and they're not going to say Las Vegas early. They're simply going to be the Athletics.
So not the old SAC Athletics.
Not the old SAC Athletics. So had that really question earlier. Now we have an answer to that question.
Really missed the opportunity there.
I'm a little offended that, and you tried to tease it before the break, and then you realized it didn't work. So apparently Woods and Paul,
yeah, this happened this morning,
thought that when I was on television, I had some sort of like food on the corner of my mouth, on my face, uh-huh, while I was chocolate. Doing live shots. Yep. Something like dark, like chocolate.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it was simply, and everyone can see it, right?
I've never seen it.
It's on the YouTube stream. It is where my dimple, yeah, kind of where comes your in dimple right is there, but
it's kind of just tucked
my
away
mole.
There.
I have mole face. And I have the triangle. I mean, if you watch me, one, two, three. We got the triangle of moles.
The Holy Trinity.
The Holy Trinity on my face. There's
the
also
Bermuda
smaller ones.
The Moly Trinity.
The Moly.
That's good, Paul. That's good. But yeah, I have
the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost.
The Moly Ghost.
The Moly Ghost. Jeez, me all day. Well, so we put on the YouTube feed up on the TV, and there was your live hit from pre-first pitch. And I go, play that. I hadn't seen it yet. And it was Kimberly Hunt back in the studio. Ben, our own Ben Higgins is out there today.
Yeah,
it's
right,
I killed that live
you
hit.
You crushed it.
That was one of my better, funnier live shots.
And when you came down for first pitch, I go, how did it go? And you go, I crushed that. And I go, no way. I go, I would have been dry mouth the whole thing. I go, Paulie, what the hell is that? And he goes, I don't know. I go, does he have chocolate on his face? No. What kind of cameraman's going to let you on and be like, hey, Ben, I know you just ate a...
What kind of 20-year news vet goes on
here? Eat a Reese's peanut butter cup right before you go on and wipe your lip. And I go, Paulie, he has chocolate on his face. Because I'd never noticed that before.
I've thought about having them removed before.
No, it's part of you now.
But ultimately, I feel like it's part of what makes me... Me.
100%.
And I don't think they're unattractive. They're certainly not, you know, Cindy Crawford beauty mark, but they're not.
Right here?
Yeah.
I love that.
They're not. I don't think they're hideous looking either. They're just there. They're just part of my face. And I truly think if I ever took them off, I would be weirded out by looking at myself in the mirror.
It's kind of like when, you know, some of our favorite stars get their teeth fixed. Like Manny, when it was an adjustment. Right? When Manny got his teeth all done and Freddie Freeman got his done and Jason Isbell got his done and you're like...
Michael Strahan pretended to get his done.
Yeah,
that was
one of the best bits of all time, though. Like, that was a really good bit. But it was one of those things where I went, oh, okay, this is going to take some getting used to. And now you don't even think about it. No, don't cut them off. Thanks. But I've watched you on the news 100 times. I've worked with you every day for 6 years.
Dan in the chat says Ben likes moles.
Yeah,
I do. I like mole. I also like guacamole.
And the Moly Trinity.
And I like that Holy Moly show, that Steph Curry miniature golf show that they have on.
And you like Steph Curry.
Mm-hmm.
Did you guys see the news that came out this morning that Tiger Woods, see the Tiger Woods news? He's given up carnal relations to prepare for the Masters. That's an actual news story that came out this morning.
I mean, he did
carnal relations.
He did quite well for many years.
That's the thing.
While heavily indulging.
Yes.
Apparently in carnal relations.
Hasn't he lost a bit of his game since going on the straight and
maybe
narrow?
Maybe he never really went on the straight and narrow.
Maybe he didn't.
He's finally trying it.
But he said, I'm in preparation for Augusta, I'm giving up carnal relations.
Feels like more it's his, you know, massive injuries and, you know, body that doesn't work anymore that's more of the problem. But if he thinks
it's
going to work for him.
Can't you, in fact, maybe injure something engaged in carnal relations that you wouldn't
maybe
normally...
Maybe the way Tiger does it.
Exactly. What are your thoughts on that? Giving up carnal relations to prepare for Augusta.
Now, don't think it's ever a question that's been asked of a professional golfer. I know athletes in other sports have gotten that that particular one before? Like, what's your policy on, like, the night before a game? Some guys say, I never do. Some guys say, oh, no, I think it helps me perform better. I've always wondered, how do you always all have the choice?
It's just like, not tonight. No.
Must be nice to have to have the choice
whether you do or not, Tiger. If giving up carnal relations guaranteed you, I would shoot 12 under at the Masters, like, easily. Like, oh, my God, this guy from nowhere is having the round of his life. Birdie, eagle, birdie, Amen's corner. He just murdered it. Oh, man, that is fantastic stuff.
So, we'll
fantastic.
I'm not going to start wagering now on Tiger. I'd like to see him actually finish an entire round.
There's no way he makes the cut. There's just no way again. I've said that about him 1,000 times.
He could there. If he can get around, he can figure out a way to at least scrape by, I think, and make the cut.
Sure.
But we'll find out next week.
All right.
Let's check traffic, and we'll get to our Throwback Thursday segments next here on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danick.
Our morning drive is wrapping up on a pretty good note here, guys. That police activity has been wrapped up on the Coronado Bridge heading over to the island. No lanes, block speeds are up to speed. Everything's looking pretty good all around the county. I'm Kelly Danick with Ben and Wood, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
Now, Polly found a couple of absolute classics, and we're going further back. We got a three-year and, what, a five or a... Even a six-year one? No, five-year one. Three and five years. So let's start with the three-year, which, as we mentioned at the beginning of the show, we are just a couple of days away, April 9th, from the three-year anniversary of Joe Musgrove's no-hitter, still the only no-hitter Padres history. The Astros have four since then, but Padres still have just the one.
Probably get another one this weekend.
but it was the day before the no-hitter, correct?
It was April 7th.
So two days before. So the 3 days from now was Joe happened to appear on our show. We didn't know he was going to throw a no-hitter.
Obviously.
But we were always excited to have him on, and everything was going swimmingly.
Yeah,
when
then
all of a sudden...
This clip starts in the middle of him talking. But
you know,
I'm going to give it a few seconds here for some context, because he was kind of on a roll, and we were really, I remember this moment. Like, we were locked into what he was about to tell us until something went wrong.
But, you know, it doesn't make it easy. You know, it's never easy. So you have to control those things. And something that I worked on a lot this offseason was, you know, being able to control my emotion on the mound and still have that intensity and, you know, that fire and the passion that I, you know, that I pitch with and that I feel like makes me successful without letting that overwhelm me and, you know, get me caught up in the moment. So, you know, I think part of the routine for me now that has really helped is.
What?
Did Joe just put us on hold?
What? What was that?
And there he's
and
gone.
We lost him. Gone. Like, it just played that weird-ass music, and then it just cut off.
It's not the first time a caller's ever dropped off.
No,
it happens all the time.
But I've never heard that.
But we've never had, like, hold music, and it was right in the middle of, like, the dramatic pause in the sentence, and it is.
You know, I think part of the routine for me now that has really helped is.
Is.
And I'll tell you after the break.
Is what?
the looks on all of our faces.
Did Joe just put us on hold?
What? What was that?
And there he's
and
gone.
We lost him. And then he just dropped off. And then he finally, like, we got him back.
Ollie, can you pull that just so we can just play
I
that
revisit
again?
It. Maybe.
We're going to have to revisit that.
You guys there?
Yeah.
he's like, I don't know. My phone just dropped off. But yeah, weird.
I was like, Paulie, did you hit something? Like, what happened? There was that weird keyboard music in there. Just never happened to me before. Hasn't happened to me since.
Like, we're in the waiting room somewhere serene.
Like how a TV show used to just turn off or we'll be back, and it's just that weird music. That was so good.
Credit to Joe Musgrove, man, for going out, doing what he did that two nights later, getting the first no-hitter, and then calling into our show the very next
morning.
That
was so cool.
Just talked to him 3 days earlier. He didn't have to do that, but I still, like, that went a long
Imagine
way.
Imagine the same player appearing on our show twice in a three-day span, Jake Cronenworth, annual guest of Ben and Woods.
Yeah, right?
You can come on more than once a year, Jake. You really can.
He always says, I might call in. Well, call in. Love to talk to Jake.
He confirmed.
More.
No, I'm an annual guest.
Yeah, it's annual. Like, once a year.
We're not limiting you. You're more than welcome to come on. You could be even monthly if you'd like.
Those guys, man. What's the other one we got, Paulie?
The other one we go way back.
Oh, and this is the way back.
This
machine.
Was today, 5 years ago today. Now, we were not at. On 97.3 The Fan.
No, we were not.
5 years ago today. The radio station doesn't exist anymore. But, and it was actually, we were probably, 3 weeks away from finally being out of a job over there?
Yeah.
End of April?
Yeah.
So April 4th, 2019, you're going to hear sound bites from another sports radio show in Arizona, Phoenix, Arizona. Was this the game where Manny dropped the bat?
Hit a foul ball.
Looked
up, kind of flipped his bat, and then the ball drifted and took the catcher over into the bat, mm-hmm. and he almost stepped on the bat, didn't step on the bat.
Almost being a key word here.
He
didn't actually step on it.
And, dude, they got on the air and just went nuts. About
and
Manny.
They were just like, you know, Manny Machado, he's a thug, he's a turd, blah, blah, blah. So we had some fun with that, and it's one of my favorite clips we've ever done.
Turdy is as turdy does, Mason audience. Never for.
Because, by the way, a show like that, all they do is listen to, like, music, like, Disturbed.
100%. And we said, well, what would, you know, what is this morning show? We just did, like, a parody of their morning show.
Yes.
Turdy is as turdy does, Mason audience. Never forget that.
Hey, welcome back to the Mighty 1090. It's Snot and Storch in the morning. Yeah! Ladies, let's see those tatas. It's your boys, Snot and Storch. Storch, what's happening, baby? You ready to get lit on a Thursday?
Snot, it's a beautiful morning here in the Valley of the Sun.
Yeah. Ben is trying so hard to
take
do the voice.
Take your tops off.
You're turning red.
I am.
You just 20 seconds of that.
I can do that bit all day long.
Paulie murdered
Paul,
the sound.
You are slaying me right now. What's up, dudes? It's Snot and Storch in the morning.
Where is the honor?
Where is the honor?
Where is it?
I'll tell you where it is. I left it at Baby Dolls last night.
He couldn't do it, man. He was trying so hard to do it. He's
where is the honor?
Megan says, I love this clip so much I would have walked down the aisle to it.
She does love that clip.
And remember,
so
only a year in, I've loosened up just
big time. Big
I will
time.
Say,
5 years.
So we just celebrated our anniversary as a show. We started on March 27th, 2018. That clip that we just played was April 4th, 2019. So a year and a week in. And I really feel like that's about the time that this show is starting to really find its
We didn't even
form.
Know what a pandemic was.
Oh, and we really went for it there. And I remember the other hosts on the station being, like, mad at us. And
that,
like,
we would, like, defend Manny, like, fanboys.
Or just, like, I don't
attack.
Know. A couple other sports radios.
Our colleagues.
Yeah, I guess. But those guys were terrible.
The Sacred Society of Sports Talk Radio Show hosts.
The literal. The
that
literal.
Never, ever criticize each other.
No, that literal.
Turdy is as turdy does.
The worst fraternity on the planet is this.
Such
one.
A respectful industry 100%. With people who do nothing but say nice things behind each other's backs all the time in this business.
Phenomenal. I loved that. We really went for it that day, and that was a lot of fun. And Paulie.
Manny Machado.
He's a turd. He's a turd.
It was the actual show was Doug and the Wolf.
Doug and the Wolf. I don't think they're on anymore.
No, we asked somebody.
We asked somebody when we were out there, for sure.
They probably have gone on to different radio partners now.
Yeah.
Steve and the Wolf.
Yeah. Bill and the Wolf. Snot and the Wolf. Storch and the Wolf.
Doug and the Bull.
Yeah. Fish and Cheese. Oh, man.
You never want to pair Fish and Cheese.
No, you
that
do
just
not.
Doesn't, that
it
doesn't
does,
work.
It does not work.
Look at the congregation we have now outside the studio. Chowing down on the round table pizza that's
yep.
here for our round table Roundtable coming up for
round
our next
table,
hour.
Roundtable, yeah.
Remember, it is a commercial-free Padres discussion weekly on Thursdays that includes, well, supposedly all of our hosts. Woodsy has to go get his stitches out today, but I think we've got Gwen and Chris, Annie and Elston are going to be joining me for the next hour, and we're going to go back this first week of the season, kind of just all of our thoughts and reflections on what we've seen. We'll discuss some of the stories we talked about earlier, the Miami Marlins, the trade rumors today coming up on the roundtable, which is going to be starting in just a few minutes.
Now, I will be listening on my any pot shots at me, because I will be listening on the drive home. You got all your questions ready?
I do have some questions. Last time I needed to come up with like 17 more of them over the course of the program, but hopefully it'll be a free-flowing, organic discussion of Padres baseball.
Yeah, I mean, that's how we do it here on 97.3 The Fan.
And then we'll be back tomorrow with a very big Friday program. Joining us in studio, our friend Jay Moore is going to be back.
Yes.
He's got a comedy show in town, I assume, this weekend.
No, he's just coming down the hang.
Just coming down the hang. That's awesome.
He wants to talk Lakers with you, actually.
I knew it. And then 8 o'clock, the Cespedes Family Barbecue guys, both of them, Jake and Jordan, will be with us. And then 9 o'clock on a Friar Friday, we will be joined by the skipper, Mike Shilton.
Man.
Good news for Mike. They cannot lose today. They do not play today, so he'll have a nice win.
Yeah, under his belt.
Under his belt from yesterday, still fresh in everybody's minds when he joins us tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. So we'll talk to you then. I'll talk to you in just a couple of minutes here on the other side on the roundtable. For executive producer and imaging director Paul Reindl, for Stephen Woods, I'm Ben Higgins. Have a great rest of your Thursday from all of us here at San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. So long, everybody.